Lipscomb Bisons baseball is on the air. Good afternoon. This is Doc Allen coming to you live from beautiful Ken Dugan Field at Stephen Lee Marsh Stadium on the campus of Lipscomb University in Nashville, Tennessee, as we get set to bring you college baseball action between the Ohio State Buckeyes and the homestanding Lipscomb Bisons. This is the third game of a three-game series, the Buckeyes capturing Friday's contest by a score of 11-6, and the Bisons claiming a walk-off 5-4 comeback win in yesterday's action. The visiting Buckeyes from Ohio State University, part of the Big Ten Conference, they enter today's game with a season record of 3 wins and 5 losses, and the Bisons from the Atlantic Sun Conference have a season record of 7 wins and 2 losses. I'm joined today for color commentary by Spencer Bohm, and prior to the game, we had a chance to visit with Lipscomb head coach Jeff Forehand to get his thoughts on today's game.
Coach Forehand, big comeback win for your team yesterday. Talk a little bit about the things they did to put themselves in a position for that walk-off win.
Well, you know, yesterday I think this team is built not to stop and not to give up on it. You know, we had the lead there. I believe it was the 7th or 6th. I can't remember what it was. But we had to came back and got the lead. And then, you know, we get one out in the 9th and you feel like, man, the momentum's going their way. And then, you know, Chris has a big walk, and then we string 3 hits together and win the game. And you know, that's just a fun way to end, but it's kind of the personality of the team.
2 outstanding pitching performances yesterday for your team. Max Habiger with another great start, and then Tyler Guilfoyle has really been lights out in 4 appearances so far this year. Talk about those 2 guys and their work so far.
You know, we changed Max's role a little bit at the beginning of the year, just to put him in a starting role to see if that would help him be able to, you know, have some, you know, go longer in games, et cetera, and he's really excelled in his 3 starts this year, in particular his last 2, and you know, put us in a great position yesterday to win the game and kept it right there. And just matched their guy, who was great, by the way, yesterday, pitch for pitch. And then Tyler really came in, had a great 1 inning for us, and just put us in that position. You know, each time he goes out, every time, all year long. So we're excited about those 2, and hopefully we can continue more of the same.
Good luck to you today, Coach.
And thank you so much.
That's Lipscomb head baseball coach Jeff Forehand previewing today's game. While we were away, you missed my co-host Spencer Bohm, who threw out the first pitch today. So we're sorry we didn't capture that on video. It was during the interview there, but it looked a little low and inside, but a fine effort from co-host Spencer Bohm. So we're going to turn it over to PA announcer Aaron Birch for our national anthem.
Would you please rise and remove your hats and face the flag located in left center field for the singing of our national anthem, performed this afternoon by Macy Tabor.
By the dawn's early light, or it so proudly reveals at the twilight's last gleaming, whose brushstrokes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so
national anthem is in the books, and we get set for baseball action between Lipscomb and Ohio State. Let's take a look at today's starting lineups. First, for the visiting Buckeyes from Ohio State, leading off, left fielder, number 24, Mitchell Oakley. Batting second, shortstop, number 4, Zach DiCenzo. Batting third, catcher, number 10, Dylan Dingler. Batting fourth, designated hitter, number 12, Brent Totus. Batting fifth, right fielder, number 39, Connor Pohl. Batting sixth, first baseman, number 29, Archer Brookman. batting seventh, center fielder number 14, Nate Carafa, batting eighth, second baseman number 43, Colton Bauer, and batting ninth and playing third base, number 5, Nick Irwin. Starter on the mound today for the Buckeyes will be the junior left-hander, Griffin Smith, number 37. The Buckeyes head coach is Greg Beals. He's assisted by Matt Engel, Dan DeLucia, volunteer assistant Kirby Pellet, director of pitching development Brad Goldberg, and the athletic trainer Paul Dawson. Starting lineup for the Bisons today, leading off at second base, number 8, Haddon Adams. Batting second, first baseman, number 30, Chris Bashler. Batting third, center fielder, number 19, Maddox Houghton. Batting fourth, designated hitter, number 44, Malik Williams. Batting fifth, hero of yesterday's game with a walk-off hit to third baseman, number 9, Knox Preston. Batting sixth, right fielder, number 21, John Shields. Batting seventh, left fielder, number 4, Ty Jones. Batting eighth and doing the catching, number 1, Chaz Bertolani. And batting ninth at shortstop, number 2, Brian Moore. Starter on the mound for the Bisons, the junior right-hander Dylan Bierman. The Bisons' head coach is Jeff Forehand in his 14th season. He's assisted by Grayson Crawford, hitting coach Ryan Price, the director of baseball operations Brian Ryman, volunteer assistant Jeffrey Cresson, and student assistant Jake Bryant. The Bisons' team manager is Spencer Marsh, head groundskeeper is Colby Rawls, and the head baseball athletic trainer is Clint Woods. Umpires for today's game, behind the plate, Chris Dykeman. At first base, Michael Thomas. At third base, Todd Mullins. And we've got 66 degrees under partly cloudy skies here at Ken Dugan Field as we get set for baseball action between Lipscomb and Ohio State. And Dylan Bierman's first pitch is outside to Mitchell Oakley. Well, I mentioned I'm joined in the booth by my co-host Spencer Bohm. Spencer, we unfortunately didn't capture that throw on the broadcast as we were in an interview, but I told the viewers you did an outstanding job. Looked a little low and inside, but you might have gotten a call. We've got a two-ball, no-strike count on the leadoff hitter for the Buckeyes, Mitchell Oakley. He swings through that one and fouls it back. Oakley was not in the lineup yesterday. Did have a couple of hits in Friday's openers. And again, third game of this three-game series between these two teams. It's been a well-played series and a lot of exciting baseball. Here's the 2-1. Swung on. Hit back up the middle. That's going to be a base hit. So Oakley is going to be on board with the first hit of the day for the Buckeyes. And that'll bring up the shortstop, Zach DeCenzo. DeCenzo comes into the game batting 300 on the season. He's got 9 hits in 30 trips to the plate, no home runs and 4 RBIs. He did have 1 hit in 5 trips in yesterday's action. He was playing over at third base yesterday, so he's rotated the weekend series. Shortstop on Friday, third base yesterday, and he's back at the shortstop position today. And he'll await the offering from Dylan Bierman. Swung on and fouled out of play. No balls and 1 strike. Defensively for the Bisons, they've got Jones in left field, Maddox Houghton in center, John Shields in right, Knox Preston at third, Brian Moore at short, Haddon Adams at second, and Chris Bashler at first, Chaz Bertolani behind the plate, and Dylan Bierman is on the mound for the Bisons. Here comes the 0-1 pitch. Swung on and hit in the air towards right field. Shields coming in, still coming in, and he's going to field it for out number 1. That was a sinking liner kind of going towards the right field line, and Shields read it off the bat and came in and gloved it for the first out of the inning. That'll bring up the catcher, Dylan Dingler. Dingler is playing in his 8th game of the season for the Buckeyes. He's batting 231, no homers, 3 RBIs. He did play yesterday and was 1-for-4 on the day and scored a run. Back and forth affair yesterday between the two teams. Outstanding starting pitching from two great left-handers. That's an off-speed pitch that stays high. 1 ball, no strike. So Bison starter Max Habiger had an outstanding start, as did Seth Lonsway, the terrific sophomore left-hander for Ohio State, who struck out 13 batters in 5 innings of work yesterday. Here comes the 1-0. Does he check his swing? And they say no, he did not. First base umpire Michael Thomas ruling that a strike. That'll even the count at a ball and a strike. So the two clubs traded 5 scoreless innings, and then scoring action in the 6th when Ohio State put up 2 runs. Lipscomb responded with 3 runs, and we were there until the 8th inning when the Buckeyes came back and put up 2 more, and they took a 4-3 lead into the bottom of the 9th inning yesterday. And he swings through an off-speed pitch there, and it's a ball and 2 strikes.
And I was at the women's game yesterday keeping track on stat broadcast when I saw the score was that close, so an exciting win for the program. I think Lipscomb is now 2-3 against Ohio State over the last 2 years combined.
We got a 1-2 offering due to Dylan Dingler. Oakley, your runner at first base. He's not going. Breaking ball just outside, 2 balls and 2 strikes. Yeah, these two clubs played a 3-game series in Ohio State last year, and it was a back-and-forth affair, as you mentioned. The Buckeyes took the first game on Friday, 14-3. The Bisons won 9-3 on Saturday, and then on Sunday it was a one-run game that Ohio State prevailed in 7-6 last year. That's a fastball just off the plate. That's going to run the count full to 3 balls and 2 strikes on Dylan Dingler. So as you mentioned, Spencer, the Bisons came into the bottom of the ninth down 4-3 yesterday, and they were able to put up 2 big runs, including the walk-off single by Knox Preston with 2 outs in the bottom of the ninth. That swung on and hit in the air towards center field. Actually, the left fielder, Ty Jones, is going to camp under it in left center field. He's gloves it for the second out. So Dingler's retired, and that is going to bring up the designated hitter, Brent Totis. Totis has 4 hits and 25 trips on the season so far. He did play in yesterday's game and did not record a hit in one at-bat officially. He did have an RBI on a sacrifice fly. So Totis bats with 2 outs and Oakley running at first. We're in the top half of the first inning. No score between Ohio State and Lipscomb. Breaking ball bounces in the dirt. Bertolotti keeps it in front of him. Count's going to be 1 ball and no strikes on Brent Totis. 2 left-handers each went into the sixth inning yesterday. Seth Lonsway for Ohio State, 5 innings, 5 hits, 4 walks, and 13 strikeouts, as we mentioned. No runs given up. And Max Habiger for the Bisons, 5 2/3 innings, 4 hits, 1 run, 1 walk, and 4 strikeouts. That looks like a fastball down low, and it's 2-0 on Brent Totis. Again, Ohio State was an 11-6 winner in Friday's game, a game which they benefited from 9 free passes and a couple hits batsmen from the Bisons. A real pitcher's duel in yesterday's game, the 2-0.
And that was that 5-run inning on Friday, too, that really helped seal the deal for Ohio State. Lipscomb made a late push, but at that point, the Bisons were down by a wide margin.
It's 2 balls and 1 strike on the cleanup hitter, Brent Totis. Pohl waits on deck. Oakley running at first, not much of a lead. That just missed. Breaking ball must have been low and outside, and it's going to be 3 balls and 1 strike on Totis. So a tight zone so far today. Home plate umpire Chris Dykeman. 3-man umpiring crew that's been with us all weekend. And we await the 3-1 pitch to Totis. Swung on, tapped foul. That's going to make the count 3-2. Very interesting sequence of events in yesterday's game as well involving the umpiring crew. The Bisons actually scored the go-ahead run in the sixth inning virtue of a delayed ball call. They had a runner on third base, and we heard something called out over the microphone. Couldn't hear exactly what was said. Nobody moved, and then Bison skipper Jeff Forehand went out and argued his case to the umpiring crew. They conferred and ended up saying, yes, a balk had occurred. So here's the payoff. Runner going. He's going to miss high. 4-4. So Totis is going to walk. Oakley's going to advance to second. And right fielder Connor Pohl is going to stand in there. Pohl batting 207 on the year. No homers and 4 RBIs. He was 0-3 in yesterday's game. He'll bat now with 2 outs and 2 men on top of the first. So, yeah, back in yesterday's game, Coach Forehand went out, argued his case. The umpires conferred and said, yes, that is a balk, and they allowed the run to score from third base. Of course, Coach Beals from Ohio State went out and argued his side of it, but he did not prevail. So that actually was the 3rd run of the day for the Bisons yesterday and turned out to be a big run in a 1-run ball game.
Balks were a topic of discussion in that Lipscomb-Samford game a week ago, too. I was in the stands for the majority of that game, and Lipscomb was able to advance on a balk in that game.
There are some interesting rules in college as far as the balk, which we'll get into as we get into today's game. We have seen 4 balks called in the opening weekend series against Bowling Green. So here's the 1-0. That's going to miss outside, 2-0. My understanding, the interpretation from yesterday is that the pitcher pitching from the stretch has to keep the foot that's not on the rubber. He cannot advance that towards home plate. There has to be some part of it near the rubber as he gets ready to start. And he also cannot step towards home plate as he initiates his motion. So that was the violation that was ruled yesterday, and it was called actually by the first base umpire. Here comes the 2-0 pitch, the Pohl. That's through there for a strike, and that'll make the count 2 balls and 1 strike.
Yeah, still a call that confuses me is the balk, because you'll see them move sometimes. Sometimes they'll pretend they're going to throw it to first base, try to pick him off. and they don't call a balk in another time.
Yeah, the move we talked about yesterday was not associated with a move towards the base. That one just off the plate with an off-speed pitch there. And that's going to make the call. They count 3 balls and 1 strike on Connor Pohl. Brookman waits on deck. We're in the top half of the first inning, and we have no score between Lipscomb and Ohio State. The Buckeyes do have 2 men on with 2 outs. And this will be the third hitter in the inning that Bierman's gone to a 3-ball count on. Swung on, tapped towards first base. Bachelor's going to glove it. Step on the bag for the out. So the Buckeyes are going to strand 2. We've played half an inning. No score between Ohio State and Lipscomb. You're watching Lipscomb Bisons Baseball on YouTube Live.
The Bisons are proud to partner with Wayne Stevens and First Bank as the official mortgage lender of Lipscomb Athletics. Wayne has been a friend of Lipscomb for over 40 years and a mortgage lender for 23 years. Based out of First Bank's Franklin branch, Wayne is the person to visit whether you are considering building or buying a house or looking to refinance. Call Wayne Stevens and First Bank at 615-814-3912 or visit them on the web at fbmortgageloans.com.
The third baseman is Nick Irwin. At shortstop, Zach DeCenzo. The second baseman, Colton Bauer. And at first base, Archer Brookman. The catcher is Dylan Dingler. And the starting pitcher, Griffin Smith.
We head to the home half of the first inning. No score between Ohio State and Lipscomb, and the Bisons will send their 1-2-3 hitters Adams, Bachelor, and Houghton to the plate to face the left-hander, Griffin Smith. Smith is a 6'2", 220-pound junior out of Cincinnati, Ohio, product of Cincinnati Hills Christian Academy. And on the season, he's no wins and 1 loss. This is his 3rd start. He's got an ERA of 7.71.
I've been impressed with Haddon Adams this year. Really stepped up in his – this is his senior season, right? Coming out of Columbia State Community College.
And he is currently the owner of a 9-game hitting streak to start the season, and you can make that 10 games. So as if on command, Haddon Adams says, I'll just take care of that hitting streak right off the bat. And he has singled safely to start it off for the Bisons in the bottom half of the first. Yes, that's 10 games in a row now at the start of the season with a base hit for Haddon Adams. So he's off to an outstanding start to that senior season. And that'll bring up the first baseman, Chris Bachelor. Bachelor also been having a big weekend, had a couple hits on Friday. He had 1 hit and 2 trips yesterday and scored a crucial run in that 9th inning rally as he had advanced all the way around after getting on board with a walk to start the inning. So he'll bat now with nobody out and a runner on first. And that's an 87-mile fastball over the outside corner, nothing and one to Bachelor. Smith, again, 3rd start of the season. He's only worked 4 2/3 innings. He's given up 8 hits, 4 runs, 4 earned, 2 walks, and 6 strikeouts on the season. That's a breaking ball. It's going to get down in the dirt. Adams is going to try to advance, and he's going to be under the tag.
Yeah, ball hit the ground after the throw. He had plenty of time afterwards to steal second.
And I think that's also going to bring out the first visit of the day of Coach Beals, who's going to go out and have a chance to catch up on things with third base umpire Todd Mullins. Yeah, the ball looked like it might have gotten there almost simultaneous or maybe before Adams, but Adams slid away from the tag and got his hand on the back part of the bag and got in there safely. So good dirt ball read there for Haddon Adams, and the count will be a ball and a strike on Chris Bachelor when we come back to activity here.
And Adams coming in to today, 4-for-4 on stolen bases. So that goes up to 5-for-5, assuming this stands, which I think it will.
Yeah, the Bisons as a team had stolen 15 out of 15 bases so far on the season, so they've been very successful on the base pass. Multiple players with a couple of stolen bases, as we'll talk about. But Chris Bashler has a one ball, one strike count, and Adams is in scoring position. Bottom half of the first inning, no score between Ohio State and Lipscomb.
And that 15 for 15, that's just a sign of really good coaching also on this squad.
1-1, swung on, hit. It's going to be a base hit into right field. It's going to hit in front of Pohl. Adams had to hold up to make sure it was going to be caught. Now the relay is going to get away from the cutoff man, first baseman Brookman, but not far enough. And so the Bisons now have runners on the corners with nobody out and two base hits in the inning. Bashler and Adams, back-to-back singles, and that'll bring up center fielder Maddox Houghton. And you got to tip your hat to this young man. He had had a very tough day yesterday going into the bottom of that ninth inning. In fact, he had had four consecutive strikeouts in his first four appearances, and he comes in and drives in a run in the ninth inning with a base hit. So outstanding job for the Bison's junior center fielder yesterday as part of that ninth inning rally. Shows bunt and going to pull off and take a strike, nothing and one. Houghton is a junior, a preseason member of the Atlantic Sun Conference all-conference team after an outstanding sophomore campaign. He's now batting 250 on the season, one homer and seven RBIs. Squares again, pulls off and takes a 91-mile-an-hour strike. Crowd thought that one might have been a bit low, but
that's what I thought. Then
home plate umpire's vote is the one that's going to count, and Chris Dykeman said, nope, I think that's a strike. So nothing and two. We'll see if they keep the bunt on here or if they let Houghton swing away. Not much of a lead for Bashler over at first. Adams running at third. That's another breaking ball that's going to go low. One ball and two strikes on Haddon Adams, or correction, on Maddox Houghton. Partly cloudy skies here today. We've got 66 degrees. By far the warmest game we've had all season in our 10th game of the year. So
yeah, 2 days ago was brutal.
Swung on, hitting the air towards right field. Pohl's going to go back, still towing back. He's going to glove it there. Adams is going to tag at third and score the first Bison's run of the day. So Maddox Houghton gets an RBI with a sacrifice fly. Adams is going to score from third. Chris Bashler held up at first base. And that's going to bring up the designated hitter, Malik Williams. Williams comes in batting 297, 11 hits and 37 trips on the year, three homers and 11 RBIs. And he's had an outstanding weekend. He was 2-for-4 yesterday and has had some very clutch two-strike hits for the Bison. So an excellent weekend for this junior college transfer, Malik Williams. One out, one run in, 1-0 Lipscomb. He watches a breaking ball inside and low for ball one. Yeah, Williams, of course, has the power swing that everybody's seen with three home runs on the year, but he's had some excellent two-strike at-bats this weekend where he's stayed inside and tried to hit the ball the opposite field and got some base hits up the middle. So nice to see him fighting off in those two-strike counts. Here's the 1-0. Swung on and fouled back to the screen, a ball and a strike. He's seen a steady diet of breaking balls this weekend, as you'd imagine, for someone with some of the prodigious home runs that he's already hit this season. It doesn't take long for word to get around that this is a strong young man who can really hit the fastball. And so he's seen a very steady diet of off-speed pitches, and we'll see how Griffin Smith elects to pitch him here. It's one ball and one strike.
I like having him fourth in the batting order, too, and that's probably why he's getting all those RBIs.
And as we mentioned, he clubs that one foul. That was an off-speed pitch, and he hit it foul down the third base side. So it's a ball and two strikes on Williams. Knox Preston waits on deck. Defensively, for the Buckeyes, Oakley in left, Carafa in center, Pohl in right, Irwin at third, DeCenzo your shortstop, Bauer at second, Brookman at first, and Dingler behind the plate. Here comes the 1-2, and that's outside and high. Two balls, two strikes on Malik Williams. We mentioned that 66 degrees. The wind is out of the south-southwest at about 15 miles an hour, so we've got a pretty good breeze blowing out towards left center field here today. Here comes the 2-2. And he swings through the breaking ball for strike three. So that's two down now in the inning, and the first strikeout on the day for Griffin Smith, and that'll bring up yesterday's hero, Knox Preston. Preston, the freshman third baseman, who, like a lot of the Bisons, had a really tough day. He had three strikeouts and a walk going into that at-bat in the bottom of the ninth when he hit a walk-off single. And so an outstanding finish to a day that had otherwise been a struggle for Preston. That's a strike in there for no balls and one strike. I saw that he said afterwards that he was determined not to swing through another breaking ball, so he got a fastball and first pitch of the at-bat, poked it out into right field for that walk-off hit. comes the 0-1, swung on, a base hit into right field. Batchelor's going to stop at second base, and Knox Preston stays hot for the weekend. Third Bison's hit of the inning. They do have one run home already, and Lipscomb's leading Ohio State 1-0 in the bottom of the first inning. And that's going to bring up John Shields. Shields is in right field today. He did have one at bat yesterday, but he got aboard via walk, did end up scoring a run. He's got 5 hits and 25 trips on the season. No homers and 6 RBIs for John Shields, junior college transfer from the State College of Florida. That's a fastball on the inside corner. Nothing in one. So Batchelor now running at second, Preston running at first. Bisons have 3 hits in the inning and have pushed across one run. Against the left-hander Griffin Smith going for the Buckeyes today. We've seen Shields play at third base. We've seen him play left field. First time we've seen him in right field. So a versatile young man that's played a number of positions already for the Bisons on the season. Here comes the 0-1 pitch. That's another fastball through there at 91. And quickly he's down in the hole, nothing in two to Shields. Jones would be next, waiting on deck. Each team with 8 hits on yesterday's affair. The Buckeyes committed 2 errors, the Bisons 1 error, but the Bisons wound up on top of the scoreboard 5-4, that walk-off win. Here's the 0-2, and he's going to get him on a strike 3. But the Bisons do pick up 1 run on 3 hits. They strand 2 men on base, and at the end of 1 inning, your score, Lipscomb 1, Ohio State 0. You're watching Lipscomb Bisons Baseball on YouTube Live.
Lipscomb Athletics would like to thank 1989 graduate Scott Hall and Nashville Insurance Group for their ongoing support. Nashville Insurance Group is your one-stop Tennessee Insurance Center. Save up to 35% on your Tennessee home and auto insurance. Call Scott Hall and Nashville Insurance Group today. Visit them on the web at nashvilleinsurancegroup.com.
We head to the top half of the second inning. Lipscomb leading Ohio State 1-0, and the right-hander Dylan Bierman back on the mound for the Bisons to face Brookman, Carafa, and Bauer, the 6, 7, and 8 hitters for Ohio State. The Buckeyes got a leadoff single in the first inning, but a couple of flyouts, a walk, and a ground out to end the inning, and that's first inning of work for Dylan Bierman. So he'll face Archer Brookman to lead off the top of the second.
Brookman's the best hitter on the team, too, with that 417 average.
He takes a strike over the outside corner. Yeah, he had 3 hits and 3 trips in yesterday's affair, so 2 runs scored and an RBI. So an outstanding day yesterday for the junior first baseman, Archer Brookman. And here's the 0-1. That's a breaking ball low. It's a ball and a strike. On the season, 417, as you mentioned. He's only had 12 at-bats, but 5 hits, no homers, and 1 RBI. And he swings through a breaking ball there, and it's a ball and 2 strikes. Brookman, for his Ohio State career, is in his first season as a junior college transfer. Swings through that. Bertolani's going to field it and throw into first, and he's down on strikes. First strikeout of the day for Dylan Bierman, and that'll bring up Nate Carafa, the center fielder. Carafa was 0-for-3 yesterday, and he comes in with just 3 hits and 27 at-bats to start this freshman campaign.
Also the only player on the starting lineup today with a home run. He's logged 1 this season and leads with 6 RBIs.
Takes a breaking ball downstairs, and it's 1 ball and no strikes. He's just a freshman, 6-foot-tall, 190 pounds, out of Toronto, Ohio. And he's going to face the 1-0 from Bierman, and he swings through another breaking ball, and it's 1 ball and 1 strike. Outfield straight away, normal depth. Second baseman Haddon Adams back on the outfield grass and shaded over towards second base. And that one's going to miss low. Two balls and one strike. We did see the Bisons employ a number of infield shifts yesterday, particularly on some of the left-handed bats, so we'll keep an eye on that as the day goes on. Here comes the 2-1, and he fouls that one at the plate. Two balls, two strikes on Nate Carafa. The Buckeyes only have two left-handed hitters in the lineup today to face the right-hander Dylan Bierman. The Bisons with one left-handed bat against the left-hander Smith. Here's the 2-2. Goes over his head, and that's going to run the count full at three balls and two strikes. Again, Lipscomb comes in with a record of 7 wins, 2 losses on the season. Got off to a 6-0 start, the best start in program history in the Division I era. Swung on and hit into left field. That's going to be a diving stop by Ty Jones. Great catch by Jones in left field. Jones read that off the bat, didn't hesitate, came in and caught it as he slid down. And so an excellent play to retire Carafa for the second out of the inning and bring up second baseman Colton Bauer. Bauer played yesterday, had 2 hits and 4 trips, had a couple RBIs, and he's now batting .385 on the season. He's only had 13 at-bats, but 5 hits, no homers, 3 RBIs for Colton Bauer. 2 outs, bases empty. That's an off-speed pitch, and they ask and said yes, they're going to call that a strike. So no balls, 1 strike on Bauer. And they're going to say he swung at that one as well. So quickly, nothing and two on Bauer as Dylan Bierman has gotten ahead of him. Coach Forehand tells us he's got a lot of run and cut on the ball. He'll throw the fastball, a changeup, a cutter, and a curveball. So a lot of offerings coming out of crafty right-hander Dylan Bierman, and there's a swing and a miss on that one. Bertolini's going to tag him.
Nice.
And it's going to be the third out of the inning. So 2 strikeouts in the inning for Bierman, nothing doing for the Buckeyes. Your score in the middle of the second inning is Lipscomb 1, Ohio State 0. You're watching Lipscomb Bisons Baseball on YouTube Live.
Fans staying invested doesn't have to mean standing still, especially when the environment isn't. Call Jeremy at George Wealth Group for a stress test of your portfolio or a checkup in your overall financial plan. For more details, go to georgewealthgroup.com or call Jeremy George at 615-599-2702.
We head to the bottom half of the second inning. Lipscomb leading Ohio State 1-0. The left-hander Griffin Smith back on the mound for the Buckeyes, facing Jones, Bertolani, and Moore, the 7-8-9 hitters for the Bisons. The Bisons with 3 hits and 1 run in the first inning. And they'll now face off against Griffin Smith here.
And got to compliment Ty Jones. He had that diving catch in left field during the top of the inning.
Yeah, excellent catch from Jones. Still looking to get on track at the plate this year. He's just 1 hit in 13 trips on the young season. And he takes a pitch like a slider in there for strike one. Swung on and foul back, and it's nothing and two. We mentioned the Bisons off to that 7-2 start. That's the best record in the Atlantic Sun Conference. They're tied with Stetson for that honor. Both teams coming in at 7-2 so far on the season.
I'm impressed with the way that this program has started, and they came back last season, too, from a rough start to get the 3 seed in the A-Sun Conference heading into the A-Sun Baseball Tournament, and they're continuing that progress this season so far.
Yeah, the Bisons won 30 games last year, 30-25 on the season. That's a breaking ball that's going to be outside and low for 1 ball and 2 strikes.
Ohio State, on the other hand, has been on the rise, too. Didn't make the Big Ten Tournament in 2017, but they've been to the NCAA Tournament the last 2 years.
Yeah, 3 out of the past 4 tournaments for this program. That swung on and fouled up. It's behind the plate. Dingler's trying to draw a bead on it. He throws the mask away, and he's going to retire Jones for the first out of the inning. So that'll bring up the catcher, Chaz Bertolani. Bertolani came in as a defensive replacement yesterday, had one at bat, didn't have a hit, but he's red hot to start the season. He's leading the Bisons with a .412 batting average. He's had 7 hits and 17 at bats, no homers and 4 RBI. So an outstanding start for the sophomore catcher, Chaz Bertolani. He was behind the plate on Friday night, and then, as we mentioned, came in yesterday. Jared O'Leary doing the bulk of the catching, as has been the norm in the first 3 weekends for the Bisons. And he swings through an off-speed pitch there, nothing and one. So, yeah, this Buckeyes program, as you mentioned, has been very strong. They won 36 games a year ago, 36 and 27, 12 and 12 in the Big Ten. Swung on, and there's a base hit up the middle.
Yeah, Bertolani just keeps getting better and better all season. He is 8th in the batting order, but as you mentioned, that .412 average leading the team so far.
That brings up the senior shortstop, Brian Moore. Moore, 1 hit in 3 trips in yesterday's affair, and he's now batting at .250 on the season. 8 hits and 32 RBIs. He has 1 home run, and 8 hits and 32 at-bats, 1 home run and 7 RBIs. He shows bunt, pulls back, and takes outside for ball one. Bertolani running at first. There's one out. We're in the bottom half of the second inning, and your score is Lipscomb 1, Ohio State nothing. Brian Moore to face the left-hander Griffin Smith. And that one's pulled back over the outside corner, and it's 1-1. Dingler did a good job framing that one and got the strike call. 1 run, 4 hits, no errors for the Bisons. 2 runs, 1 hit, no errors for the Buckeyes as we battle in game 3 of this 3-game series. We mentioned that each team has won a game, so this is the rubber game of this 3-game series. And here comes the 1-1 to Moore. Swings through the breaking ball. Looks like a slider there, and it's going to be 1-2. We'll catch up on all the Atlantic Sun Conference scores from yesterday as well as today. All the teams in action. We know that Lipscomb beat Ohio State 5-4 yesterday. Stetson came back and beat UMBC 8-7 in a comeback win. And Liberty defeated Marist 6-4. 1-2 is going to go to first instead. Some other A-Sun scores from yesterday's action. NJIT beat Bucknell 14-2. Kennesaw State beat Penn 8-1. Florida Gulf Coast lost, or correction, defeated Bethune-Cookman 5-3. Swung on and hit in the air in the infield. It's over toward the left side. Third baseman Irwin's calling for it. He's going to get back a couple of steps and glove that one. And Moore will be retired for the second out of the inning. Second baseman. So that brings us back to the top of the order in second baseman Haddon Adams. He led off with a base hit, came around and scored a run in the first inning. That's the Bison's 1 run on the day. And in doing so, extended his hit streak now to 10 games. He's had a hit in every single one of the Bison's 10 games on the season for the senior second baseman Haddon Adams. He's out of Murfreesboro, Tennessee, and Columbia State College, as you mentioned. Bertolani running at first, 2 outs. That one's going to be down the dirt for ball one. A couple of other A-Sun scores from yesterday. Jacksonville lost to Austin Peay 11-7. North Alabama lost 7-3 to Little Rock, and Hartford defeated North Florida 13-2. So a bit of a surprising start for that North Florida club picked at the top of the conference. They're now 2-7 on the young season.
Yeah, this is a surprise.
There's a breaking ball in there for a strike, and it'll be a ball and a strike on Haddon Adams. The Bisons and Stetson both 7-2 so far. Liberty at 6-4. NJIT at 5-4. And Kennesaw State 5-5 in the top half of the conference. All non-conference action early in the season. Swung on, hit towards right field. Pole's going over, still going over. And he's under it and is going to glove it for the third out of the inning. So Haddon Adams hit that one well, but it was able to be tracked down by the right fielder Connor Pole. So the Bisons strand a runner after getting 1 hit in the inning. They've now left 3 through the first 2 innings. And your score at the end of 2 innings, Lipscomb 1, Ohio State nothing. You're watching Lipscomb Bisons Baseball on YouTube Live.
The Elite Kids Zone is located in the South Concourse of Allen Arena during basketball games. Throughout the year, there will be inflatables, balloon animals, and other fun activities. Check out the Kids Zone in the South Concourse for a great time at Bison basketball games, including on Tuesday night at 7 p.m. Central as the 3-seeded Bisons take on the 6-seeded Eagles of FGCU.
We head to the top half of the third inning. Lipscomb is leading Ohio State 1-0, and the right-hander Dylan Bierman is back on the mound for his third inning of work. So far through two innings, he's given up one hit, no runs. He's walked one and struck out two. And he's going to face Irwin, Oakley, and DeCenzo, the 9-1 and 2 hitters for the Ohio State Buckeyes.
I've liked how Bierman's played so far. I liked how the outfield has played so far as well. Lipscomb putting a solid performance together.
And that's going to miss low for ball one. Irwin did come in the game yesterday, did not have an at-bat. He was a defensive replacement at second base, and he's only had three at-bats on the season. And he swings and hits this one behind third base. Shortstop Brian Moore with a long run. He's going to yield to the left fielder Ty Jones. He's going to catch it in fair territory for out number one. So that one was hit behind third base. Jones with a long run, but he came over and gloved it. Back to the top of the order, and left fielder Mitchell Oakley. Oakley has been red hot this weekend. Couple hits on Friday, didn't play yesterday. And he led off the Buckeyes' first inning with a base hit and was stranded, as the Buckeyes stranded a couple of runners in the first inning. Swings and taps this one toward the shortstop Moore. He's going to be up with it, throw to first, and retire Oakley. So that'll bring up shortstop Zach DeCenzo. He was retired in the first inning on a fly ball out to right fielder John Shields. So he is now 0-for-1 on the day. 9 hits and 31 at-bats on the season for the sophomore Zach DeCenzo. He batted .257 a year ago, played in all 64 games that the Buckeyes played, had 10 homers and 40 RBI. So outstanding freshman campaign for DeCenzo, and he's back now for his sophomore year.
Yeah, part of that squad that played here in Nashville last season during that Vanderbilt regional.
And he swings through a fastball there, and that's going to even the count at a ball and a strike on Zach DeCenzo. Dingler would be next on deck. That's it. One ball, one strike count on DeCenzo. That one's going to bounce up there as well. Two balls and one strike. So it's been a big weekend of sports activity on campus for Lipscomb. The Lady Bison softball team has been hosting the Purple and Gold Classic, and they've got 2 wins in 3 games so far, and another one yet to play today. I'll tell you about that in a moment. That one misses downstairs, 3 balls and 1 strike. Lady Bisons are due to take on Indiana State at 2:30 start over at the Draper Diamond. That's going to miss inside for ball 4. DeCenzo is on with a 2-out walk.
Lady Bisons have had a nice start this season. Took Texas down to the wire last weekend. Also shut out Duke 2-0. It's a team that is trying to repeat its appearance in the NCAA tournament last season. They're not favored to do so, but they certainly should have the talent. Megan Gray is 7-0 as a pitcher.
Yeah, outstanding start for Coach Ryman and her Lady Bison softball team. As we mentioned, they've won 2 out of 3 on the weekend and have one more to go this afternoon. Dylan Dingler is going to bat, and DeCenzo, your runner at first, 2 outs. That one's just off the plate for ball 1. Dingler flew out to left field and is only at bat so far today. So we'll update you with that softball score as we have it. Also, a big win for the Bison's basketball team. Men's basketball defeated Liberty yesterday to lock up the number 3 seed in the A-Sun Conference Tournament. So a senior day victory for Coach Acuff and the Bisons.
Completely unprecedented, but I mean, I'm not as surprised that they beat Liberty, because they had them. They lost by 7 points last time the two teams played. What I was surprised about was the 29-6 lead with 11 minutes to go, and the fact that the Bisons were able to jump Stetson, which lost by 1 point to Jacksonville, for that 3 seed. So they'll host FGCU, a team that Lipscomb beat last time around.
2 balls, no strike to count on Dylan Dingler. He swings, grounds this towards third baseman Preston. He's up with it, throws to second for the force out there.
Outfield is playing tremendously today for Lipscomb. Nothing going for Ohio State.
So the Buckeyes are retired in the third inning, and that brings us to the middle of the third. Your score is Lipscomb 1, Ohio State nothing. You're watching Lipscomb Bisons Baseball on YouTube Live.
Lipscomb Athletics thanks 1988 graduate Dan Stephen and Stephen & Associates for their partnership and support. Stephen & Associates will help you with personal and business financial decisions, retirement planning, asset management, life insurance, college funding strategies, estate planning, and more. Increase your planned retirement income by up to 40%. Make the wise decision and call Stephen & Associates today. Visit them on the web at sandawealth.com. That's sandawealth.com.
We head to the home half of the third inning. Your score is Lipscomb 1 and Ohio State 0. And left-hander Griffin Smith back out on the mound for the Buckeyes. He's going to face Batchelor, Houghton, and Williams. 2, 3, and 4 hitters for the Lipscomb Bisons, who have 1 run on 4 hits, no errors. No runs, 1 hit, and no errors for Ohio State. And Chris Batchelor had a base hit with a solid single back in the first inning for the Bisons. He stands in and watches a fastball that's outside for ball one. We were mentioning the success of the softball team and the men's basketball team. That's breaking ball low, 2-0. Also, the tennis teams, both the men's and women's tennis teams have picked up 2 victories on the season, and the men's tennis team is off to a 9-0 start, best start in program history, as they're undefeated with 2 match wins on Friday and Saturday. So kudos to the Bison tennis program, who finished up their indoor part of the season, and will start their first outdoor matches next weekend, right next door here to Dugan Field. It's a 3-ball, no strike count on Chris Batchelor. Houghton waits on deck. Here's the 3-0, right through there, 3-1.
Let's hope they don't have a tennis game going on at the same time as a baseball game, because some of those balls fly onto the court during fouls.
There is an opportunity for that to happen. Here comes the 3-1 to Batchelor. That's going to miss outside, ball four. That's going to be the first walk of the day for Griffin Smith, and it puts Batchelor aboard with nobody out, and then brings up Maddox Houghton. Houghton drove in a run in the first inning with a sacrifice fly, and we'll see how Coach Forehand elects to play it here. One thing we noted yesterday, Batchelor, as we mentioned, has been a catcher in his first couple of seasons with the Bisons, moving to the first base designated hitter role this year, and he's really slimmed down considerably and has become a feared base runner, so he's got some speed. Great bunt towards third base. Going to be fielded by Irwin. He's going to come up with it and throw. And Batchelor is going to try to advance to third, and he's going to be tagged out.
Oh.
So that was the pitcher Smith covering over at third base. And what we saw is that Batchelor hesitated just a little bit coming around second. He saw that third base was unoccupied, but the pitcher Smith sprinted over there and covered the bag. And so an unorthodox double play there, as you see that one go 1-3 back to, or correction, that was going 5-3 and then back to 1 for the double play. So 2 outs now, bases empty for Malik Williams, and that one's going to bounce in there for a 1-ball, no strike count. It was a good bunt from Houghton.
Yeah, I thought we were going to have a sacrifice bunt and have Batchelor on second base, but he decided to run to third, and just not so sure about that.
He rounded second, saw that third was unoccupied, but at the same time, the pitcher, Griffin Smith, noted it as well, and he had a shorter run to get there than did Chris Batchelor. First baseman Brookman alertly saw that, threw over there, and Smith was able to put the tag down. So a bit of an unorthodox 5-3-1 double play. And we've got a 1-ball, 1-strike count on Malik Williams, batting with 2 outs and the bases empty. That's going to be grounded foul as well, another breaking ball, so 1-ball, 2 strikes. Williams was a strikeout victim in his first at-bat in the first inning. 4 hits for the Bisons. Only 1 run to show for it so far, playing in the bottom of the third inning. Here comes the 1-2. Checked his swing. Did he not? Nope, they're going to say he went. So there's another strikeout. So an inning that started with a lot of promise for the Bisons ends quietly, and we've played 3 full innings at Dugan Field. Your score, Lipscomb 1, Ohio State 0. You're watching Lipscomb Bisons Baseball on YouTube Live.
Bill Prady with Smart Source has had the privilege of serving the Lipscomb University community for 35 years. Smart Source provides the most innovative approach to printing promotional apparel and paper products supported with technology-based services such as direct mail, fulfillment, and development of marketing resource centers. Please call Bill Prady at 615-516-0434. That's 615-516-0434 for a consultation.
We head to the top half of the fourth inning. Your score, Lipscomb 1, Ohio State 0. Fans, a reminder that today and every home Sunday is Sunday Fun Day. That means all kids 12 and under get to run the bases on the field after the game and the Bison's players will be available for autographs. So come on out to the ballpark. You've still got time to join us on this sunny and warm Sunday afternoon. Great baseball action between Ohio State and Lipscomb. And it is Sunday fun day.
Do they let media members run the base?
I'm not sure about that one, Spencer. I'll have to get a ruling for you on that one. This is going to be Brent Totus leading it off for the Buckeyes. He's going to watch a slider outside, one ball and no strikes. Totus walked and was stranded back in the first inning. Again, he's got four hits and 25 trips on the season so far. Swung on and hit in the air towards center field. Houghton going back, and he's under it. Four out, number one. So Totus is retired, and that'll bring up Connor Pohl, who grounded out to the first baseman Chris Bashler back in the first inning, 0 for 1 on the day. We mentioned every Sunday is Sunday Fun Day. Some other promotions to keep an eye on. Every Friday is Dollar Dog Night, $1 hot dogs for all Friday night games. Also, every Tuesday is 2 for 1. You can get two tickets and two beverages for the price of one. And Thursdays are fan bingo days where they pass out bingo cards and have prizes associated. So lots of promotions for the upstanding or upcoming Lipscomb home games. Be sure to come out to the ballpark and support your Bisons.
Yeah, as I've said before, take advantage of $1 hot dogs. That is a luxury not afforded very often.
No balls, one strike on Pohl. That's going to be a slider. Looks like that misses outside, one ball and one strike. So we've seen Bierman throw to both sides of the plate so far. Again, he's someone that cuts that baseball on both sides. You'll see him move it around side to side. Throws the changeup, throws the curveball, has that cutter and that fastball with a lot of movement. That's going to be a base hit down the left field line. Jones is going to be over to cut it off. He's going to make the turn and head towards second, and here comes the throw, and he's going to be in there with a double. So Pohl hit that right down the third base line. The Bisons actually were in somewhat of an infield shift. Third baseman Preston was pulled way off the line. Don't think he'd had a play anyway. That one right down the line sliced away from the left fielder Jones. And Pohl is going to be on at second base now with one out for first baseman Archer Brookman. Brookman was a strikeout victim back in the second inning. So we mentioned the Bisons using some different defensive shifts throughout the weekend, some of these hitters. And they have a bit of a shift on now with Brookman up. The second baseman Adams is playing very close to the bag, trying to cut down that lead for the runner Pohl. He stays in that general vicinity as he watches an off-speed pitch for strike one on Brookman. Outfield is normal depth and fairly straight away. But as I mentioned, the second baseman Haddon Adams shifted over for the pull side for the right-handed swinging Brookman. Swung on and tapped towards third base. Preston's going to field it in fair territory.
Just bumps, barely.
And throws him out at first. Pohl has to hold at second base, so Brookman is retired on the ground out to Preston at third. That was just inside the foul line. He caught it right on top of the foul line, made a strong throw to first, and that brings up Carafa. Carafa's 0 for 1 today. He flew out to left field. An outstanding catch made by left fielder Ty Jones back in the second inning. Two outs, runner at second base. Lipscomb leading Ohio State 1-0 in the top of the fourth inning. Dylan Bierman's gone all the way for the Bisons, and another excellent start for the junior. That one misses inside and high. Ball one to Carafa. Bierman is a 6'2", 205-pound junior college transfer. We mentioned out of Tulsa, Oklahoma, and Johnson County Community College, where he was a teammate of first baseman designated hitter Malik Williams, who's in the lineup today at DH for the Bisons.
That's always fun when you get...
That one's hit foul down the third baseline.
It's always fun when you get teammates from community colleges transferring, playing in the same space. That happened when Lipscomb and Tennessee Tech played in their home-and-home in basketball. Parker Hazen with Lipscomb and Amadou Sila with Tennessee Tech both played at Iowa Western Community College last season.
It's a one ball, one strike count on Carafa. Two outs. Your runner at second is Connor Pohl, who doubled with one out and has been out there watching the action unfold. Lipscomb leading Ohio State 1-0 in the top of the fourth inning, and Bierman's going to step off. One other Lipscomb team in action this weekend is the women's golf team. They're at Kiowa Island for the Kiowa Island Classic that's going on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. So we wish good luck to the Lady Bison golfers. That's an off-speed pitch that's going to stay high, and it's going to be 2-1 on Carafa.
And I wanted to mention, too, Ohio State's women's track team won the Big Ten championship yesterday in the indoor races. So congratulations to the Buckeyes of Ohio State for winning the Big Ten championship yet again, defending their title.
Yeah, very historically strong track program for the Buckeyes. Here comes the 2-1. Swings through an off-speed pitch there and misses it. Two balls and two strikes. Bauer would be next. He waits on deck. So, again, we've seen Bierman throw that slider, cut fastball, and really had a changeup that was quite effective on that pitch. So he's now got Carafa in a two-ball, two-strike count, two outs, and Pohl running at second. And he swings through that one for strike three.
Nice. Lipscomb's outfield is playing a stellar campaign right now.
So a third strikeout of the day for Bierman, and the Buckeyes will strand another runner. That's four on the day that they've stranded so far. We're in the middle of the fourth inning, and your score, Lipscomb 1, Ohio State 0. You're watching Lipscomb Bisons Baseball on YouTube Live.
Lipscomb University would like to thank John Roberts Automotive Group for their support of Bison Athletics. Both Lipscomb graduates John Roberts Sr. and John Roberts Jr. have been serving the Middle Tennessee community since 1983. Just a short drive to Manchester, Tennessee, or just a click away at johnrobertsautogroup.com will save you plenty on one of your family's most important purchases. Please visit either John Roberts Toyota or John Roberts Nissan for all your new, pre-owned, or automotive service needs.
We're headed to the home half of the fourth inning. Lipscomb leading Ohio State 1-0. And the Bisons will send up Preston, Shields, and Jones to face the left-hander Griffin Smith. Preston, again, the hero of yesterday's walk-off game, and he singled in his first at-bat today. So now on the season, knocks Preston with six hits and 20 trips. I believe that computes to a .300 batting average. So Preston off to a good start in his freshman campaign. He's a local youngster here out of Nashville, Tennessee, played at Christ Presbyterian Academy for his high school ball. He watches that one over the inside corner, and it's no balls and one strike on Preston. That's a breaking ball. It's going to stay down low, and it's a ball and a strike. We'll catch up to speed on some of the scores of the Atlantic Sun Conference teams and also some of the Bison's future opponents as we go along. A lot of baseball action going today. Pulls the string on that one and gets him to swing through it. And it's a ball and two strikes on Knox Preston. Left-hander Griffin Smith working in his fourth inning, the 6'2", 220-pound junior out of Cincinnati, Ohio. Here comes the 1-2. Swung on, tapped up the middle. It's going to be cut off by DeCenzo. He's going to field it and throw, and he's going to get him. Nice play there by DeCenzo to retire Preston. So that'll bring John Shields to the plate. Shields was a strikeout victim, caught looking back in the first inning. Three strikeouts on the day for Smith against one walk. Bisons do have four hits on the day. So some of the scoreboard on the Atlantic Sun, New Jersey Tech and Bucknell are, looks like, running late with their scheduled start. Liberty does lead Marist 2-0 in the top of the seventh, and Jacksonville leads Austin Peay 5-0 in the sixth. Swings through a breaking ball for strike one to Shields. Other A-Sun action, Kennesaw State leading Pennsylvania 3-1 in the seventh. Stetson leads UMBC 4-0 in the seventh. Swings and fouls it back. Bethune-Cookman is leading Florida Gulf Coast 6-0 in the bottom of the fifth. North Florida leading Hartford 5-1 in the bottom of the seventh. And I believe that's all of the A-Sun scores that we have. Swings through that one. Four strike three, so Shields is down on the strikeout for the second time, and that's the second out of the inning, and the fourth strikeout for Smith. That's going to bring the left fielder Ty Jones to the plate. Jones fouled out to the catcher Dingler back in the second inning. Still looking for his first base hit on the day.
And would be just his second of the season, too. Granted, it is very early, but
he swings through an off-speed pitch there. No balls and one strike. Yeah, Jones batted .274 last year as a freshman, played in 28 games, made 19 starts, had an on-base percentage of .425. So you know he's an outstanding hitter. Just Slow start in some of these seasons. He swings through a breaking ball there, and he's down in the count. No balls and two strikes. Generally early in the season, a lot of times you see the pitchers a little ahead of the hitters as hitters haven't seen that live pitching. Takes some time to get into it. So you expect Ty Jones will break out of this and come back and show what he's capable of at the plate. That's a ball high, and it's one ball and two strikes on Jones.
And right before then, Griffin Smith had pitched six strikes in a row, not including the ground out.
Yeah, he seems to be finding a rhythm and having a better chance locating that breaking ball than he did in the early innings. As I say that, he throws one about 58 feet, so I put the jinx on him there. Two balls, two strikes to Jones. But he has settled in and, in fact, had a 1-2-3 inning in the last inning, although it featured an unusual double play on a bunt play. So Smith's done a nice job. Excellent starting pitching on both sides throughout this entire series. Both teams have had very effective starts from their pitchers. That one swung on and hit on the ground towards Bauer at shortstop. He's up with it, and that's going to retire Jones for the third out of the inning. So another 1-2-3 inning for Griffin Smith. The Bisons have nothing going. We're at the end of the fourth inning. Your score, Lipscomb 1, Ohio State 0. You're watching Lipscomb Bisons Baseball on YouTube Live.
The Bisons are proud to partner with Wayne Stevens and First Bank as the official mortgage lender of Lipscomb Athletics. Wayne has been a friend of Lipscomb for over 40 years and a mortgage lender for 23 years. Based out of First Bank's Franklin branch, Wayne is the first person to visit, whether you're considering building or buying a house or looking to refinance. Call Wayne Stevens and First Bank at 615-814-3912 or visit them on the web at fbmortgageloans.com.
We head to the top half of the fifth inning. Your score, Lipscomb 1, Ohio State 0. And due up for the Buckeyes, 8-9-1. Bauer, Irwin, and Oakley to face Dylan Bierman. Bierman's pitched all four innings, given up only two hits, no runs, two walks, and three strikeouts for the junior right-hander in his third start of the season. And Bauer stands in there, looks at a breaking ball just outside for ball one. Bauer was a strikeout victim back in the second inning. As we mentioned, Bierman with three strikeouts on the day through the first four innings of work. We're in the fifth inning here, and Lipscomb leading 1-0. That's a breaking ball in there that's going to check a swing and take for a strike. Even the count at a ball and a strike on Bierman. We did have a defensive change during our half inning there. Vaughn Watson has replaced Shields out in right field, so Watson in right field now for John Shields.
About a 93% on fielding. 12 putouts, one assist, one error for Vaughn Watson, and he's actually started in all seven games that he has played up to this point, so first time he has not started in a game he's played.
Here comes the 2-1, swung on hit towards Preston. It's going to be off his glove and into left field. Jones is going to field it, and Bauer's going to make a big turn, but he's going to hold it first base. We'll see how they score that. They score that as a base hit, so Bauer hit that one hard, kicked over Preston's glove at third, and he's on board as the leadoff man. The top of the fifth brings up third baseman Nick Irwin. Irwin flew out into left field back in the third inning, so he is 0-for-1 on the day. Again, Irwin only with four at-bats on the season so far, so 0-for-4 so far on the season for sophomore Nick Irwin at third base today. And he takes a fastball in there, high, one ball, no strikes. Bison outfield straight away and normal depth. Infield's a double play depth up the middle. Preston a step or two behind the bag at third, shaded over towards the line. Although Irwin did not show bunt on that particular pitch. Both teams playing a little bit of small ball yesterday with some bunts and some stolen bases, as you'd expect in that tight pitcher's duel. Each team did wind up with eight hits, but through five innings it was a back and forth pitcher's affair with the two dominant left-handers. That's an off-speed pitch that's also going to stay high, and it's 2-0 now on Nick Irwin.
Bison's Go ahead.
No, the Bisons this week head to Middle Tennessee on Tuesday. They'll play a single game there at 3 p.m. And then next weekend, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, three games in Tuscaloosa against Alabama. So end of an 11-game homestand to start the season. Lost one game to Rain. And on the road this weekend. Swung on. Hit in the air. Deep towards left field. Jones going back. Still going back. Gone. Home run.
Well, I was about to say, I wonder, you know, at what point will this game break open in the last three innings like it did last time? But Ohio State showing some offensive firepower here in the top of the fifth.
So that's Nick Irwin's first home run on the season. He did not have a home run in his career thus far at Ohio State. So he's given the Buckeyes a 2-0 lead here in the top half of the fifth inning. And that takes us back to the leadoff hitter, Mitchell Oakley. Oakley singled in the first and then grounded out in the third. So he's 1-for-2 on the day. And he takes that one high for ball one. So now 2 runs, 4 hits, no errors for the Buckeyes. 1 run, 4 hits, no errors for the Bisons. Courtesy of the 2-run home run from Irwin. And he swings through an off-speed pitch there, and it's 1-1 on Oakley. Here comes the 1-1. Just off the inside corner, 2-1. Some of the crowd did not agree with that call from the home plate umpire Chris Dykeman. We've got a great crowd on hand here this afternoon. We've had great crowds all weekend, but a really excellent crowd for this warm Sunday afternoon baseball action between Lipscomb and Ohio State. Here's the 2-1, swung on and hit towards Moore at short. He's going to glove it, throw on the run, and he gets it. Nice play by Brian Moore. That's 1 down in the inning, and that takes us to shortstop Zach DiCenzo. DiCenzo flew out to right field in the first, walked in the third, and was stranded. Again, he 9 hits and 31 at-bats on the season for DiCenzo. He's off to an excellent start to his sophomore campaign. 1 out and the bases are empty in the top half of the fifth inning. 2 runs already home here for the Buckeyes.
And forgive me if you said this already, but for Irwin, that was his first career home run just a moment ago. He didn't have any last year in his freshman campaign and put in a 2-run there just a moment ago.
Swung on and hit on the ground towards Moore. He goes to his left, grabs his feet, throws. And another nice play by Brian Moore.
Nice job by Moore recovering because he slipped there. Looked for a second like he might not have enough time, but he recovered very quickly.
Had to go back on that ball and was actually on the outfield grass as he had to get his feet and gather under him. So now 2 outs and Dylan Dingler will hit. Dingler 0-for-2 on the day. He flew out back in the first inning and was retired via fielder's choice in the third. So he stands in with the bases empty and 2 outs. But Ohio State now leading 2-1. And that's a fastball high. 1-1, no strikes on Dylan Dingler. We mentioned the Bison's upcoming schedule. The Buckeyes are about to embark on a tour of the Atlantic Sun Conference.
Mm-hmm.
So he swings and misses there. Their next action will be at Stetson on March 6th. And then they play Harvard and Fairfield in a round robin down in Florida. Then they play at North Florida for 2 games. And then they go home and host Liberty. So they'll be playing nearly half the A-Sun Conference here in their early season. That's a fastball misses outside. 2-1 on Dingler with Totus waiting on deck. The home opener for the Buckeyes, as we mentioned, March 13th, 3-game series against Liberty, and then they open Big Ten play a week later, hosting Rutgers for a 3-game series.
A-Sun is a very good conference in baseball, too. I think they were ranked 7th last year out of all conferences, so makes a lot of sense. They got a lot of schools in Florida, warmer weather, but Ohio State doing itself a favor by scheduling these teams in the A-Sun.
Here comes the 2-2 pitch to Dingler. Swung on and hit foul down the third baseline, and we'll do it again at a 2-2 count. Yeah, a lot of northern teams like to come down and start those campaigns on the road and play against those warm weather teams. Buckeyes playing about 15 games on the road to start their season before they get home to host Liberty. Swung on and hit again towards Moore. Up, gets under his glove, and that's going to get into left field. Jones is going to cut it off, and Dingler's going to make a wide turn. They're going to give him a base hit on that one as well.
Ohio State putting Moore to work right now.
That's the third base hit of the inning for the Buckeyes. And with 2 outs, that'll bring up the designated hitter, Brent Totus. Totus walked back in the first, flew out to center field last inning in the fourth. So he'll bat now with a man on and 2 outs. Buckeyes leading Lipscomb 2-1 in top half of inning number 5. This game moving right along here as both pitchers have done an excellent job. A lot of good defensive plays on both sides, so we'll see how Bierman elects to pitch to Totis. That breaking ball stays high and outside. The Bisons are in a shift right now, one of those shifts we've mentioned. The second baseman, Haddon Adams, is all the way on the third base side of second and back on the outfield grass. And shortstop Ryan Moore is more towards the traditional hole between third and short. We're going to have a visit to the mound by pitching coach Grayson Crawford. While that's happening, we'll catch you up on some scores from some other area teams that are future opponents for the Bisons this year. We mentioned earlier that Jacksonville leading Austin Peay 5-0 in the bottom of the sixth. Tennessee leading George Washington 8-0 in the seventh. Mercer is leading Tennessee Martin 10-2 in the bottom of the sixth. Memphis leading Western Illinois 6-2 in the top of the third. Bradley leading Tennessee Tech 5-1 in the bottom of the third. Belmont leading UNC Asheville 2-0 in the bottom of the fourth. South Carolina Upstate leading Western Kentucky 5-3 in the top of the sixth. And Tulane leading Middle Tennessee 5-2 in the top of the third. We mentioned that the Bisons will be at Middle Tennessee over in Murfreesboro on Tuesday. The first pitch scheduled for 3 p.m. Central Time for the next action for the Bisons. So Coach Crawford has chatted with Dylan Bierman. They got a one ball, no strike count on Brent Totis. And that one catches the outside corner to even the count at a ball and a strike. So as we mentioned, a shift is on. Third baseman Preston swung way over towards the third baseline. More in the traditional six hole. Second baseman Adams on the third base side of second base, right on the outfield edge. Swung on and hit foul. And that'll take the count to a ball and two strikes. With that shift, the outfield's fairly straight away and in normal position. So infield shifted over. There's a huge hole on the right side of the infield because the first baseman Bachelor is holding the runner on. So essentially there is a lot of open real estate. If Totis were able to put this toward the right side, he would only have to poke it in that direction. Here comes the 1-2. Runner going. Here's the throw from Bertolani, and he's going to throw him out. So Chaz Bertolani throws out Dylan Dingler trying to steal a base, and that will end the threat. But the Buckeyes do put up two runs on three hits in the inning, and they now lead Lipscomb 2-1 in the middle of the fifth inning. You're watching Lipscomb Bisons Baseball on YouTube Live.
Lipscomb Athletics would like to thank 1989 graduates Scott Hall and Nashville Insurance Group for their ongoing support. Nashville Insurance Group is your one-stop Tennessee Insurance Center. Save up to 35% on your Tennessee home and auto insurance. Call Scott Hall and Nashville Insurance Group today. Visit them on the web at nashvilleinsurancegroup.com.
We're headed to the home half of the fifth inning. Your score is Ohio State 2 and Lipscomb 1. And left-hander Griffin Smith now pitching with the lead. He'll face 8-9-1, Bertolani Moore and Haddon Adams for the Bisons here. Bertolani had a single in his first at-bat, so he's 1-for-1 on the day to continue that red-hot start that he's had for the 2020 season. Threw a breaking ball there, no balls and one strike. So the line so far on Smith, he's worked 4 innings, 4 hits, 1 run, 1 earned. He's walked 1 and struck out 4. So an excellent start for both of these starting pitchers. The left-hander Griffin Smith, the right-hander Dylan Bierman. Comes the 0-1. That one's going to bounce, and it's going to be a ball and a strike to Bertolani. You saw Bertolini throw that runner out. He's done an excellent job throwing out base runners so far on the season. Very athletic behind the plate. Does a great job blocking and quick release, and you saw it there. Swung on and hit. Third baseman Irwin's going to glove it, and he's going to retire Bertolini at first. I'll bring up shortstop Brian Moore. Moore popped out to third base back in the second inning. Mentioned he's been off to a hot start of the season. He was the Atlantic Sun Conference Player of the Week after the opening weekend series against Bowling Green. And he's continued to make excellent defensive plays, as you saw in that last inning, with a couple of great stops from Brian Moore. So outstanding defensive start, also a good offensive start. He's got 8 hits and 33 trips to the plate, 1 home run and 7 RBIs. And he swings through that off-speed pitch there. It'll be no balls and 1 strike on Moore. Breaking ball is going to stay low, even the count at a ball and a strike. Dimensions of the field here at Dugan Field, 330 down the foul line, 375 to the power alley, 400 to straightaway center field. It is a symmetric fence, and the wind's blowing out towards left center field. And that's going to be a breaking ball down low for 2 balls and a strike on Brian Moore.
Very symmetrical. Now, if you go to the Hawk, just a few miles up the road where Vanderbilt plays, they got a monster green wall because that stadium is sandwiched between the football field and Memorial Gymnasium.
Hit hard on the ground towards third base, but again, Irwin is going to glove that one, and so Irwin responsible for both of the outs so far in the bottom of the fifth inning. That's going to bring us back to the leadoff hitter, Haddon Adams. He singled back in the first to extend that 10-game hitting streak and then flew out to right field in the second, so 1-for-2 for Haddon Adams on the day. He's now got 13 hits and 36 at-bats to start the season, 1 home run and 5 RBIs, and he looks at a fastball in there for strike one. So Smith really has settled in. He seems like his control has gotten better as he's worked. Certainly the control of the breaking ball has. And he misses low with that 90-mile-an-hour fastball. And so it's 1 ball and 1 strike to Haddon Adams. No activity in either bullpen yet. This is 60 pitches that I have for Smith, so he's been very efficient. Adams lays off that, and they say he swung. So that's going to be strike two, and it's going to be 1 ball and 2 strikes on Haddon Adams. Like an off-speed pitch on the outside corner. And the 1-2. That one bounces up there, 2-2. Again, 2 outs, bases empty. Bottom half of inning number 5, and Ohio State leading Lipscomb 2-1. Rubber game of a 3-game series. The Buckeyes winning 11-6 rather on Friday, and the Bisons winning in a walk-off 5-4 yesterday here at Dugan Field. Here comes the 2-2 to Adams. And just outside, and that's going to run the count full. 3 balls, 2 strikes. Batchelor waits on deck if Adams were able to reach. Here's the payoff. Swung on and hit softly to the third baseman, Irwin, who will glove it. So Irwin records all 3 outs in the inning and nothing doing for the Bisons here. We've played 5 complete innings. Your score, Ohio State leads Lipscomb 2-1. You're watching Lipscomb Bisons Baseball on YouTube Live.
Fans, staying invested doesn't have to mean standing still, especially when the environment isn't. Call Jeremy at George Wealth Group for a stress test of your portfolio or a checkup in your overall financial plan. For more details, go to georgewealthgroup.com or call Jeremy George at 615-599-2702.
We head to the top half of the 6th inning. Ohio State 2 runs on 5 hits and no errors. Lipscomb 1 run on 4 hits and no errors. Brent Totis will be back at the plate. He was batting when Dingler was caught stealing to end the 5th inning. And here to do the play-by-play, Spencer Bohm.
Well, a big thank you to Dr. Sills for letting me take over for this inning. Again, as you mentioned a moment ago, 2-1 lead for Ohio State over Lipscomb. With Dylan Bierman pitching and Brent Totis hitting. And because he was only 1-2 last time, He is still out here to swing, and he's going to drive that one into an empty center field just right of center and head to first. Nobody was there to pick that one up and gets an easy one. So that'll bring Pohl up. One for two today.
Right fielder Connor Pohl.
Connor Pohl had a double his last time around in the fourth inning. They had a ground out in the first. His season average just 154, but seen some activity today. Bierman pitching for Lipscomb has five innings, five hits, two runs, two of them earned, two walks. As this one's going to be drilled right into the hands of the second baseman, Haddon Adams. And actually make that Brian Moore the shortstop. My bad. So one out quickly. Pohl is retired, and Brookman 0 for 2 today, the junior. Archer Brookman is in. Had a ground out earlier today. And a strikeout in the first inning. On the way, just outside for a ball one. Second one on the way, and a swing and a miss. They got him. Count goes to 1-1 here with one out. And again, Totis is on first for Ohio State. On the way, low and inside. One and make that 2-1. Bierman, his pitch count is over 80 now. On the way, that one finds the zone. It's 2-2. Curved on its way over, and Brookman decided to hold. Try to pick off first base. Totis stays put. Still a 2-2 count with one out. On the way outside. Count will fill. Totis will stay. Pertolani picks up the wild ball.
Activity down in the Bison's bullpen. Junior right-hander Wyatt Folsom is throwing. Folsom did pitch 2 1/3 innings in yesterday's game.
So again, counts 3-2. Totis on first. Brookman has yet to register a hit today, as he will step away from the plate and quickly step back in. One out for the Buckeyes and a 2-1 lead here in the top of the sixth. Here goes. And they're going to say that one was outside the zone. So runners on first and second. Brookman walks to first. Totis goes to second. One out. And the Buckeyes leading 2-1 in the top of the sixth. They'll bring on Carafa, the freshman, also 0 for 2 today. A season average of 103. Carafa earlier today struck out. And I believe fouled out earlier. So again, one out for Ohio State, and Bierman still on the mound, allowed a home run in the last inning. And now a conversation will ensue at the mound between Bertolani and Bierman.
Gives us a chance to remind you about the Bison's upcoming home schedule. Next home game will be on Tuesday, March the 10th, when the Bison's will host Austin Peay here at Dugan Field, scheduled to start at 4:05. And then the Bisons are home for a three-game series hosting Akron, March 13, 14, and 15. There'll be a 4:05 start on Friday, 2:05 start on Saturday, 1:05 start on Sunday. All of those are Central Time.
And that one goes no swing. It's 0-1 for Carafa. And again, one out. That one almost hit Carafa on the way. It is 1-1. Bierman's thrown over 90 now. It'll be interesting to see if they bring it back out after this one. After this inning, this one's outside. It is 2-1. Nick Carafa, 6-foot freshman from Toronto, Ohio, with a 2-1 count right now. For Ohio State. Swings, that one falls to the ground for a foul. It's 2-2. Bierman this season has struck out 14. He's registered 3 today.
Yeah, excellent start for Dylan Bierman. He's kept his team in the game, pitched here into the sixth inning, giving up only 2 runs and 6 hits. So another outstanding start for the junior Dylan Bierman.
As those 2 runs came on that home run earlier, giving Ohio State its 2-1 lead here in the top of the sixth. This one is drilled right into the hands of Brian Moore. He'll pick off Totis at second base and retire the side. What a play. Lipscomb prevents the Buckeyes from getting anything going there. The Buckeyes lead 2-1 here in the middle of the sixth inning. We will step aside.
For over 40 years in the mortgage lender, for 23 years, based on his First Bank's Franklin branch, Wayne's the person to visit whether you're considering building or buying a house or looking to refinance. You can call Wayne Stevens in First Bank at 615-814-3912 or visit him on the web at fbmortgageloans.com.
We head to the bottom half of the sixth inning. Ohio State leading Lipscomb 2-1. Due up for the Bisons 2, 3, and 4, Bashler, Houghton, and Williams. And to call the action, here's Spencer Bohm.
Big thank you again to Dr. Sills for letting me take over for the sixth inning. Again, a 2-1 lead for Ohio State. But Chris Bashler up to bat. He's advanced to second on both of his trips. And Griffin Smith still pitching for Ohio State as well. Has allowed 4 hits today, swing and a miss on the first one. It's 0-1. Bashler this season registering a .294 average. That one falls down the center of the zone. No swing. Makes it 0-2. And the bats have slowed down for Lipscomb here in the last few innings ever since they got a run and a few hits in that first frame. This one's going to be darted right in the center field. Bashler heads to first base.
Good piece of hitting there from Bashler. Didn't try to do too much with that pitch. Just hit it right back where it came from. And Bashler's on with his second hit of the day. And his hot weekend continues.
Maddox Houghton is in for Lipscomb. 0-0 today, .250 season average. Although he did have a sacrifice fly in the first frame. And No outs for the Bisons. And Batchelor on first for Lipscomb. Houghton shows bunt. And that one goes through the zone, 0-1. Griffin Smith has now reached 70 pitches at least on the day.
We saw this same scenario in the last time up that Houghton was there when he bunted into a double play. As Smith came off the mound, fielded the ball through to first, and Batchelor tried to advance to third base and was thrown out. So it was an unusual 5-3-1 double play the last time that Houghton was at bat.
Speaking of Batchelor, they just tried picking him off just now, but he will stay put. 0-1. Swing and a miss. It's 0-2. No outs for the Bisons. Two up for Lipscomb is Malik Williams, who has 3 home runs on the season. And if Houghton can get to first base, Ohio State might want to start to worry a little bit. He'll let that one fly. It's a little low. It counts 1-2 for Maddox Houghton. Here it goes out. Oh, they called that one a strike. I was about to say outside, but that'll do it for Maddox Houghton, and Malik Williams is in. Batchelor remains at first. It's a 2-1 Ohio State lead here in the bottom of the sixth with Lipscomb batting. Malik Williams today is 0-2. Has struck out swinging and struck out looking. He'll let that one fly for a strike. Batchelor not showing too much of a lead. As Williams will let that one stay on the left side of the strike zone, or on his right side of the strike zone. It'll be 1-1.
Just 74 pitches on the day now for the left-hander Griffin Smith. He's been very efficient through his first 6 innings.
Mm-hmm.
In contrast to yesterday when the Bisons were able to run the pitch count up on Lonsway and get him out of the game finally, and they were able to break through.
Darted backwards, foul ball. It's 1-2. With one out for Lipscomb. Yeah, Griffin Smith today, 5 hits, 1 run, 1 walk, 5 strikeouts, and he's faced 21. Malik Williams facing a 1-2 pitch. Williams bats this one high into right field, but not far enough. It's going to drop on the ground, and Williams will go to first. Batchelor goes to second. I thought for sure that was going to be caught in the outfield by Pohl.
A long run for Pohl there. He was obviously playing Williams deep, respecting that power, and so that ball just floated out over first base, kept drifting out there, and it was too far out of the reach of Pohl, and that puts Williams on and 2 runners on now with 1 out for Knox Preston.
Yeah, Williams on first, Batchelor on second, and just 1 out for the Bisons. And Preston up to bat for Lipscomb. He had that game winner on the walk-off in which Houghton scored yesterday. This one on the way inside, ball 1.
See some activity in the Ohio State bullpen. Can't get a number of who's throwing down there, but there's activity in both bullpens, both Ohio State and Lipscomb showing some activity here in the late innings.
And this one darted into center field. Will Carafa have room to catch it? Yes, he will. Bassler's going to head to second. And Williams will remain put. 2 outs for Lipscomb, but they got Williams on first and Batchelor on second. Third, sorry, correction. So Vaughn Watson, who has checked in for Lipscomb, replacing John Shields, is up to bat. Watson had previously played and started in all 7 games that he had been a part of. And the catcher, Dingler, will head to the mound to talk to Smith.
Looks like we're going to have a visit to the mound from pitching coach Dan DeLucia, and that might be all for Smith. As we mentioned, he's only at 77 pitches, but it's two outs and this tight 2-1 ball game. Two runs, six hits, no errors for the Buckeyes. One run, six hits, and no errors for the Bisons as we play in the bottom half of the sixth inning. Reminder, fans, that today is Sunday Fun Day. All kids 12 and under get to run the bases after the game, and Bisons players will be available for an autograph. So if you're still in the neighborhood, come on out and catch the end of this exciting tilt between Ohio State and Lipscomb and enjoy Sunday Fun Day. That's also the case for every Sunday home game for the rest of the season for the Bisons. One of a number of promotions that we have. We mentioned that every Friday is Dollar Dog Day and $1 hot dogs on all the Friday night home games. One other promotion to tell you about. The weekend that we host Kansas, it'll be April the 9th, there is a commemorative scorecard giveaway on that weekend. So be sure to be one of the first fans in attendance and get your scorecard.
2-1 lead for the Ohio State Buckeyes here in the bottom of the sixth with the Bisons batting. Watson knocks this one into left field, and it's going to be picked up, I believe, by Oakley. And that'll retire the side. So the Bisons able to get runners on first and third, but they will be stranded, and they head to the seventh inning down 2-1. Up to bat for Ohio State will be Colton Bauer.
New pitcher for the Bisons, number 18, Tyler Sills.
We head to the top half of the seventh inning. Your score is Ohio State 2 and Lipscomb 1. Two runs, six hits, no errors for the Buckeyes. One run, six hits, and no errors for the Bisons. And thanks to Spencer Bohm for his inning of work there. New pitcher on the mound for the Bisons, the sophomore right-hander Tyler Sills, a 6-foot-tall, 165-pounder out of right here in Franklin, Tennessee. He's on for his second action of the year. He's pitched one inning, given up one hit, no runs, no walks, three strikeouts. And he'll face 8-9-1, Bauer, Irwin, and Oakley for the Buckeyes. Top half of inning number 7, 2-1 Ohio State. And that one misses high and inside for ball one. So Dylan Bierman goes the first six innings with another very effective start on the day. And he swings through that curveball, and that'll even the count at a ball and a strike. It's a slider that's going to miss low, and it's two balls and one strike on Bauer. So Bierman, final line, six innings, two hits, two runs. Both earned, three walks, three strikeouts for six innings, and a very effective start for Dylan Bierman. Swung on and fouled, and that'll make the count two balls and two strikes. Coach Jeff Forehand telling us that Sills is a guy that'll throw the fastball, the slider, changeup, and a curve, so four different offerings. A guy that's around the zone, typically throwing a lot of strikes. So Tyler Sills facing Colton Bauer for the Buckeyes. We got a two-ball, two-strike count. And that's going to be a slider missing low, and that'll run the count full, 3-2. Bauer Struck out back in the second inning and singled and scored on the home run by Irwin in the fifth. So he's 1-for-2 on the day for Colton Bauer. On tap towards the mound. Seals is going to field it. He's going to step and throw. And Bauer's going to be retired. That's one down, and that brings the third baseman, Nick Irwin. Irwin flew out to left field in the third and then homered in his last at-bat. So 1-for-2 on the day for Irwin. Now on the season, he's 1 hit in 5 trips and does have that home run. Outfield straight away in normal depth. Adams back on the grass at second base. And fastball is going to miss high for ball one. Again, third game of a 3-game series. Ohio State winning on Friday and the Bisons winning a walk-off yesterday. That one's going to be called a ball, and it's going to be 2 balls and no strikes on Nick Irwin. Same pattern as last year when these two teams met. They split games Friday and Saturday and then played a 1-run affair on Sunday. So very similar story playing out thus far here in the series. Here's the 2-0. Now it's going to catch the inside corner with a slider. 2 balls and 1 strike. Preston and Bachelor both playing deep and on the line here in the late innings, as you'd expect. That one's going to miss just low, and it's going to be 3 balls and a strike on Nick Irwin. Leadoff hitter Oakley waits on deck. And that one's going to miss low as well, so Irwin's going to reach on the walk. So that'll bring up the leadoff hitter Mitchell Oakley. Oakley singled to lead off the game, and he's grounded out twice, so 1 hit in 3 trips for Oakley. He's now got 4 hits in 11 at-bats on the season. And it looks like we're going to have a pitching change here. Coach Jeff Forehand signaling to the bullpen. While we do, we will update you on some scores from the Atlantic Sun Conference and also from some of the area teams. They've gone final now with Little Rock leading North Alabama 2-1, or beating Alabama, North Alabama 2-1. Liberty leads Marist 3-0 in the top of the ninth. Jacksonville leading Austin Peay 5-0 in the bottom of the eighth. Pennsylvania leading Kennesaw State 5-3 in the top of the ninth inning. Stetson has defeated UMBC 5-0. Bethune-Cookman has opened up a 9-0 lead on Florida Gulf Coast in the bottom of the seventh. North Florida leads Hartford 7-2. And that is your A-Sun scoreboard update. We will update some other area teams here.
New pitcher for the Bisons, number 29, Logan Van Treek.
Tennessee leading George Washington 9-0 in the bottom of the eighth. Mercer is leading Tennessee Martin 10-4 in the bottom of the eighth. Memphis has opened up a 10-2 lead on Western Illinois. Bradley leads Tennessee Tech 6-1 in the top of the sixth. UNC Asheville has come back to tie Belmont. It's now 2-2 in the top of the sixth. And USC Upstate is leading Western Kentucky 9-7, top of the seventh. And one more score, Tulane leading Middle Tennessee 6-4 in the bottom of the fourth. We mentioned that the Bison's next action will be on Tuesday when they play at Middle Tennessee in a 3 p.m. start. Again, that's Tuesday, March the 3rd, 3 p.m. Central start for Lipscomb at Middle Tennessee.
I think that Lipscomb-Memphis game, Lipscomb at Memphis, is on the 17th, if I'm correct. If I have a chance, I might go to that one because I've never been to Memphis before. So that would be a good opportunity to go see the Bisons on the road.
New pitcher on the mound is the left-handed freshman Logan Van Treek. He's 6'4", 200-pounder out of Lincoln, Nebraska, Lincoln Southeast High School. Van Treek on the season is making his fourth appearance. He has a record of no wins, one loss, an ERA of 8.71. 10 1/3 innings. He's given up 9 hits, 10 runs, 10 earned. He's walked 9, and he struck out 8. And he is inheriting a situation with 1 out. There's a runner at first base. That's Irwin. Bauer grounded out to the pitcher to lead off the inning, and then Irwin reached on the walk. And we're back to the top of the order. Oakley, again, your score is Ohio State 2 and Lipscomb 1. And we're playing action here in the top half of the seventh inning. Van Treek did throw in Friday's action, did not see action yesterday. He's going to throw to first and Chase Irwin back. Still got some activity down in both bullpens. Looks like Wyatt Folsom still throwing in the Bison's bullpen. And I believe Will Fennig throwing in the Ohio State bullpen. That one's just off the outside corner of the plate. One ball, no strikes to Oakley. Zone's gotten a little tight here in the seventh inning. And Van Treek is facing Oakley with a 1-0 count, one out, runner on first base. Wind's picked up and really blowing hard towards that left field line now. It's about 14, 15 miles an hour earlier, but it's blowing straight towards the left field line. And he swings through the off-speed pitch, and that'll even the count at a ball and a strike. So Bierman started another outstanding start where he went the first six innings, giving up six hits, two runs, two earned. Sills on in relief, faced two batters here, and the third pitcher of the day is Logan Van Treek for the Bisons. That one's going to miss low, and the count's going to be 2-1. Move to first, and kind of that hesitation move that you'll see those left-handers use sometimes, but Irwin is able to get back. Irwin does not have a stolen base on the year. The Buckeyes did attempt a stolen base earlier in the game, but catcher Chaz Bertolani threw the runner out, so 0-for-1 on the day for steals for the Buckeyes. And again, they're going to throw over to first base and chase Irwin back. So two ball, one strike count on the leadoff hitter, Mitchell Oakley. That's a breaking ball over the outside corner, and that's going to even the count at two balls and two strikes. DeCenzo waits on deck. And here comes the 2-2 from Van Treek to Oakley. It's not going to be made. It's going to go to first base instead. About to get underway with softball action next door at Draper Diamond as the Bison, Lady Bison softball team hosts Indiana State. They're scheduled to start any moment now. Here comes the 2-2 to Oakley. Swung on. Flared towards shortstop. Brian Moore ranging over under it. And he's going to glove it for the out. So that's two down now for the shortstop, Zach DeCenzo. DeCenzo is 0-for-2 on the day with a walk. He flew out to right field in the first. He walked in the third. And then grounded out in the fifth. And I believe we're going to have another pitching change here. So Logan Van Treek comes in and does the job he's asked to do by retiring Oakley. And as we have this call to the bullpen, we'll step aside. You're watching Lipscomb Bisons Baseball on YouTube Live.
Lipscomb University would like to thank John Roberts Automotive Group for their support of Bison Athletics. Both Lipscomb graduates, John Roberts Sr. and John Roberts Jr. have been serving the Middle Tennessee community since 1983, just a short drive to Manchester, Tennessee, or just a click away at johnrobertsautogroup.com. We'll save you plenty on one of your family's most important purchases. Please visit either John Roberts Toyota or John Roberts Nissan for all your new, pre-owned, or automotive service needs.
Number 11, Wyatt Folsom.
New pitcher for the Bisons is the junior right-hander Wyatt Folsom, 6'3", 205-pounder out of Denton, Texas via Fort Scott Community College, and he's on for his second appearance of the weekend. Folsom did pitch yesterday, which 2 1/3 innings, gave up 2 hits, 2 runs, 2 were earned, walked 1, and struck out 3, and threw 35 pitches yesterday. On the season, this is now the 6th appearance for Folsom. He's got a record of 1 win, no loss, and an ERA of 3.86. He's worked 7 innings total, given up 5 hits, 3 runs, 3 earned, walked 2, and struck out 4. So Folsom, the 3rd Bisons pitcher of the inning, still started, relieved by Van Treek, and now Wyatt Folsom. And our situation is 2 outs. Runner at first base is Nick Irwin, and Zach DiCenzo is going to stand in there. We're playing in the top half of the 7th inning, and our score is Ohio State 2 and Lipscomb 1. Both teams with 6 hits on the day. Neither team has committed an error. And he takes a off-speed pitch over the outside corner. No balls and 1 strike on DiCenzo. Defensively for the Bisons, Jones is in left, Houghton in center, Watson in right, Preston at 3rd, Moore at shortstop, Adams at 1st, Adams at 2nd, Batchelor at 1st, and Bertolani behind the plate, and that almost gets away. Batchelor with an athletic play to keep that one from rolling around and giving Irwin a chance to advance here.
And just a reminder for those of you who might have just tuned in, Vaughn Watson did replace John Shields a couple of innings ago in the outfield for Lipscomb.
So it's a no ball and 1 strike count on Zach DiCenzo. Swung on, hit in the air towards left field. Jones is coming in, still coming in. Camped out under it, and he's out. So Folsom comes in and does his job by retiring DiCenzo, and there's nothing doing for the Buckeyes in the 7th inning. They've now stranded 5 runners on the day. And as we head to the 7th inning stretch, your score, Ohio State 2 and Lipscomb 1. You're watching Lipscomb Bisons Baseball on YouTube Live.
The Elite Kids Zone is located in the South Concourse of Fallon Arena at basketball games. Throughout the year, there will be inflatables, balloon animals, and other fun activities. Check out the Kids Zone in the South Concourse for a great time at Bison basketball games, including on Tuesday night, as the 3-seeded Bisons host the 6-seeded Eagles of FGCU.
We head to the bottom half of the 7th inning. 7th inning stretches in the books. Your score is Ohio State 2 and Lipscomb 1. And a new pitcher on the mound for the Buckeyes, the sophomore right-hander Will Finnig. Finnig is a 6-foot-tall, 177-pound sophomore out of Mason, Ohio. And he's making his first appearance on the weekend.
Yeah, has a 4.5 ERA. Just 1 appearance this season. Has pitched 2 innings, but 5 strikeouts and no walks for Finnig.
So Fittig will play 7, 8, and 9, Jones, Bertolani, and Moore for the Bisons. In the bottom of the 7th inning, a back-and-forth affair for these two teams who played a tough pitcher's duel yesterday, and the Bisons won in a walk-off in the bottom of the 9th. So just as it's expected to play out, similar to what happened last year between these two teams in a 3-game series, Jones swings through something, and I believe that might have hit him. Like it might have hit him on the inside of his knee, and that's certainly going to hurt. He's going to need a minute to shake that one off, is Ty Jones. We'll tell you that Finnig is a sophomore. Last year as a freshman, he appeared in 25 games. He had 3 starts. He had a record of 2 wins and 4 losses, a 4.77 ERA. He worked 60 and a third innings, gave up 67 hits, 39 runs, 32 were earned. He walked 29 and struck out 58. So 58 strikeouts and 60 and a third innings for Will Fittig as a freshman. And he now pitches as a sophomore here for this veteran Ohio State club. Looks like Jones is going to be able to shake it off and stay in the game. We mentioned that Ohio State had all three of their weekend starters that came back from last season's NCAA team in Burren, Lonsway, and Smith. They had 280 innings they threw last year and six starting position players back. So quite the opposite of the Bisons, who have almost an all-new pitching staff this year. Swung on and foul straight back. That's going to be over our heads.
Yeah.
And it's going to be a no-ball two-strike count on Ty Jones. Yeah, the Bisons lost all three weekend starters and their closer from last year's rotation. So three brand new starters, new closers, and new relievers all around. So a very youthful pitching staff for the Bisons against this experienced Ohio State club.
And only giving up two runs at that.
So no ball, two strike pitch is coming to Jones. Swung on and hit towards right center field, and that's going to get down for a base hit. Pulls over to cut it off. Jones is going to head towards second, and he's going to be safe in there.
Wow, I thought for sure they had him. When
ball clearly, the ball clearly got there before him, but it looked like he was able to get in under the tag. And
yeah, that was a good job. He maneuvered himself around Bauer, I believe it was, who should have had the automatic out on that one.
Pohl had to run a good ways to cut that off in the right center field gap, but he came up throwing, but his throw was a little bit high. Pulled DeCenzo off the bag, and Jones was able to slide in. I guess that foul ball off his leg didn't bother him too much there. He put it to the stress test there. That's going to bring up the catcher, Chaz Bertolani. Bertolani singled and was stranded back in the second inning and then grounded out in the fifth. So he's batting for the third time today. Again, our score is Ohio State 2 and Lipscomb 1, but the Bisons have their leadoff runner on at second base in the bottom half of the seventh inning. Second Buckeyes pitcher of the day, Will Fittig, after Griffin Smith worked the first six innings and Bertolani's bunting. Fittig is going to have to try to field it. He's going to get in the way of the third baseman, Irwin, and Bertolani's going to reach.
Yeah. They were having trouble picking that one up. Irwin and Fennig didn't seem like they agreed who should have the ball, and that gave plenty of time for Bertolani to get the second. And I knew Jones would get to third base, no question, but
it was a good bunt by Bertolani, and it looked like that Fennig was going to try to field it. Third baseman Irwin must have called him off, and they did a little dance with each other, and it ended up that no one had a chance to make the play. Bertolani running well down the line. So now there's runners at the corners and nobody out for the shortstop, Brian Moore. Moore 0 for 2 on the day. He's popped out to third base and grounded out to third base. Now 8 hits and 34 trips on the season for Brian Moore, the senior shortstop for the Bisons. He shows bunt. He's bunting towards the right side. Here comes the play at the plate, and not in time. They throw it away. That's going to allow Bertolani to go all the way towards third, where he's going to be in safely.
Wow, a couple of mistakes by the Ohio State outfield has this game all tied up.
I believe that's going to go as an error, but it's going to allow Moore to reach first base, Bertolani to get all the way to third, and Ty Jones has scored the tying run, and the Bisons have tied this thing up 2-2 on the error on that bunt. So an excellent safety squeeze there from Brian Moore. You can see the third runner at third, Jones, was reading that, but I don't think they had a chance at him at the plate. But the pitcher, Fittig, picked that one up and threw it wildly. And that allowed Bertolani to get all the way over to third. I think he'd have been stuck at second. So, again, runners are at the corners now with nobody out. In the top of the order, Haddon Adams, who's 1-for-3 on the day. He shows bunt and takes a 92-mile-an-hour fastball for strike one. Adams led off with a single and scored a run in the first. He flew out to right field in the second and then also flew out in the fifth inning. So, 1-for-3. He did extend that 10-game hitting streak that he has to start the 2020 season for the senior second baseman Haddon Adams. So the Bisons, as they did yesterday, keep clawing back and making some noise in the late innings here. He shows bunt, pulls off again, and takes another fastball for strike two. Now nothing and two on Haddon Adams. Bertolani running at third, Moore running at first with good speed. We'll see how Coach Forehand elects to play it, whether he keeps the bunt on with two strikes or if he allows Adams to swing away. Outfield straight away in normal depth. Infield at double play depth up the middle. Third baseman Irwin is about even with a bag. That's a breaking ball that's going to miss low. And the count's going to be one ball and two strikes on Haddon Adams. Again, Smith started, went the first six innings, gave up six hits, one run, one earned, walked one, and struck out five. So an excellent start for the left-hander Griffin Smith. And now Will Finnig on as the second Buckeyes pitcher of the day. The count's 1-2 on Haddon Adams. Swung on, hit in the air towards right field. Pohl going back, still going back. Bertolini's going to tag at third. Here he comes. Here comes the throw. It's going to be cut off, and the Bisons lead.
And just like that, this is perfect timing for Lipscomb because the bats had been struggling for the most part after the first inning, and now they got a couple of runs to take the lead on Ohio State. This is big.
Two runs and two hits in the inning, and the Bisons do take a 3-2 lead. There's still just one out. Brian Moore held up at first base, and that's going to bring first baseman Chris Bashler to the plate. Bashler singled back in the first, walked in the third, and singled in the sixth. So he's 2-for-2 on the day and has been red hot this weekend. And I'm sure Coach Forehand would love to see him stay red hot. Chris Bashler now with 11 hits and 35 at-bats on the season. Throw over to first, and Moore's back. So a great job of hitting there by your leadoff man, Haddon Adams. Poked that out for a nice sacrifice fly, allowing Bertolini easily to score. And the Bisons have taken the lead here 3-2 in the bottom half of the seventh inning. One out. Moore, your runner at first base. That's going to be a slider that misses low. 1-0 on Bashler. Jones led off with a double, a single ball he hit into right center field and took second on the throw. And then Bertolini put down a bunt that was mishandled and it turned into an infield base hit. And then Brian Moore bunted and another throwing error on that, and followed by the Haddon Adams sacrifice fly. And that's allowed the Bisons to push across two runs here. Up, they might have him. And they do. Moore's going to get picked off of first. He was trying to get back and he tripped and sort of stutter stepped there. So that's going to be two outs now with Bashler batting, and the count is 1-0. I don't know if Brian was running on that pitch, but he just looked like he got a cleat caught in the dirt as he was trying to get back. And so now two outs and bases empty for Bashler. And he misses high, and the count goes to 2-0. Houghton would be next on deck. Become kind of overcast here at Dugan Field. Wind blowing out toward left center field, as we mentioned earlier. That swung on and hit in the air towards right field. Pohl's drifting over towards the foul line. Still going over. And he's going to glove it just inside the foul line for the third out of the inning. But the Bisons do strike for two runs on two hits. They didn't leave anybody on base. And your new score after seven full innings. Lipscomb 3, Ohio State 2. You're watching Lipscomb Bisons Baseball on YouTube Live.
Lipscomb Athletics thanks 1988 graduate Dan Stephen and Stephen & Associates for their partnership and support. Stephen & Associates will help you with personal and business financial decisions, retirement planning, asset management, life insurance, college funding strategies, estate planning, and more. Increase your planned retirement income by up to 40%. Make the wise decision and call Stephen & Associates today. Visit them on the web at sandawealth.com. That's sandawealth.com.
We're headed to the top half of the eighth inning. Your new score is Lipscomb 3, Ohio State 2. And there's a new pitcher on the mound for the Bisons. The number 17, Tyler Guilfoyle, the 6'4", 201-pound sophomore out of Lexington, Kentucky. Guilfoyle is on now for his fifth appearance of the year, and he has absolutely been lights out. A one win, no loss record, three saves on the year, five innings pitched. He's yet to allow a hit, has not allowed a run. He's walked two and struck out six. He did pitch yesterday where he worked one inning and had one strikeout. So Tyler Guilfoyle is on to try to help the Bisons hang on to this 3-2 lead. We're in the top half of the eighth inning, and he'll be facing the heart of the order, 3, 4, and 5, Dingler, Totis, and Pohl. And he misses downstairs for ball one. Dingler is 1-for-3 on the day. He flew out in the first inning. He grounded out on the fielder's choice in this third and then singled and was caught stealing in the fifth inning. That one just off the plate. And it's going to be 2 balls and no strikes on Dingler.
And Guilfoyle has a chance to give the Bison something real big, which would be a 2-out-of-3 against an Ohio State team that won the Big Ten tournament last year and an 8-2 start to the season. So a couple of monumental innings coming up for Lipscomb.
That one misses low, and it's 3 balls and no strikes on Dingler. Totis waits on deck. Now fills straight away and deep, as you'd expect. Second baseman Adams shaded up the middle and is back on the outfield grass a couple steps. Here comes the 3-0. And they're going to say that misses as well. So ball four. And Dingler is aboard. So, again, the zone's kind of tightened up as we've gone along here today. That's going to bring up the designated hitter, Totis. Totis walked in the first, flew out to center field in the fourth, and singled in the sixth. So he's 1-for-2 on the day. Now in the season, he's got 5 hits and 27 trips, no homers and 3 RBIs. So Dingler is running at first base. He's 1-for-2 on stolen bases on the season. And right through there for strike one.
And Guilfoyle has accounted for all 3 of the Bison's saves from pitchers this season as well. So, as you mentioned, he's been super efficient.
Fourth Bison pitcher of the day, Dylan Bierman started. He was relieved by Tyler Sills, Logan Van Treek, and now Tyler Guilfoyle. And here's the 0-1. And excuse me, swing, and he fouls it off, and it's quickly nothing and two. Again, excellent start from Bierman today. 6 innings, gave up 6 hits. 2 runs, 2 earned, walk 3, struck out 3. Sills and Van Treek both worked a third of an inning and did not allow a run, and then Wyatt Folsom came in and got the third out of that inning. So 1 out recorded by each of 3 different pitchers back in the 7th to hold the Buckeyes scoreless. Here comes the 0-2. Just off the plate, 90-mile-an-hour fastball. And as I mentioned, the crowd not especially enamored with that call. There's going to be some discussion among the natives, I think, with home plate umpire Chris Dykeman. But nonetheless, it's going to be a 1-ball, 2-strike count on Brent Totis. That one's going to miss high, and that's 2-2.
And Guilfoyle, I'm going to guess that he lives a nonstop, very busy life, because not only is he playing college baseball, his planned major it was mechanical engineering. And as far as I'm concerned, he still is an engineering major. And the workload that people who study engineering have is crazy.
Big strikeout there of Totis, swing and a miss for strike one. And so first strikeout on the day for Guilfoyle, and that'll bring up the right fielder, Connor Pohl. Pohl grounded out to first base in the first, doubled in the fourth, and then lined out to shortstop Brian Moore back in the sixth. So he's 1-for-3 on the day. And the Bisons are going to go into that defensive shift that they've been using on Pohl most of the weekend. Shortstop Brian Moore is shifted over to the first base side of second base. He's back towards the back of the outfield dirt. The second baseman, Haddon Adams, playing in what would traditionally be the hole between first and second. And of course, first baseman Bachelor holding on the runner. Swung on and fouled straight back over our heads, and it'll be nothing and one to Pohl. Despite that infield alignment, the outfield pretty much straight away and deep. The only infielder on the left side of the infield is third baseman Knox Preston, and he's about 15 feet off the line and a couple steps behind the bag. So this is the defensive alignment the Bisons have been using on Pohl throughout the weekend. And Guilfoyle has gotten ahead. No balls and one strike. There's 1 out. Top of the 8th inning. Lipscomb leading Ohio State 3-2. And Pohl asks for and receives timeout. Looked like he got it on his second request there, but Dykeman gave him the umpire, home plate umpire Chris Dykeman gave him the timeout, so we'll remain at no balls and one strike. Dingler, your runner at first, Pohl batting with 1 out here in the top half of the 8th inning. one's going to miss inside, and it's going to even out the count at one ball and one strike. Again, next home game here at Dugan Field, Tuesday, March the 10th, when the Bisons will host Austin Peay, 4:05 start time. And then the Bisons have a weekend series where they're hosting Akron. Friday the 13th will be at 4:05, Saturday the 14th at 2:05, and Sunday the 15th at 1:05 p.m. Also a reminder, fans, that every Tuesday home game is 2-for-1 Tuesday. That means two tickets and two beverages for the price of one. Every Thursday is bingo day here at Ken Dugan Field. Fans get a bingo card, which they'll fill out through the course of the game, depending on game action, and win prizes. Fridays are dollar dog night, $1 hot dogs. And Sundays, just like today, are Sunday fun day. Kids 12 and under are going to get to run the bases after the game, and they're going to have autographs from Bison's players. So a lot of kids on hand. Great crowd on hand here this afternoon. We've had great crowds all weekend for this series between Ohio State and Lipscomb. And we've got a one ball, one strike count. There's one out. Connor Pohl is batting. Tyler Guilfoyle on the mound. And Dylan Dingler is running at first base. And he swings through that one. Gets away from Bertolani. He goes over and gloves it. Throw to second. And not in time. So it's going to be a one ball, two strike count on Pohl. Bertolani did a great job just to get to that ball. It bounced probably 15 feet away from him. He ran over and pounced on it, quickly released it, and made a play of it at second on what I thought would not even be a contested play. So excellent play there by Bertolani, but it does allow Dingler to get down to second, but it's a one ball, two strike count on Pohl.
It seems like Guilfoyle is starting to find a rhythm, too, after giving up four balls to Dingler just a moment ago. So
we mentioned that Guilfoyle did work an inning yesterday, only threw eight pitches, though, so a very short outing yesterday, and he's coming on here in the eighth inning to try to protect this 3-2 lead for Lipscomb. Here comes the 1-2. Swung on and fouled out of play, and it'll remain one ball and two strikes on Connor Pohl. Brookman waits on deck for the Buckeyes. Three runs, eight hits, and no errors for the Bisons. Two runs, six hits, and the scoreboard lists no errors. I got to believe there was a throwing error in that last inning that might not be up there, as that bunt that was attempted to be thrown home was thrown wildly and allowed Bertolani to get an extra base. But the important count is the runs, 3-2 in favor of Lipscomb right now. Here comes the 1-2 pitch. Swung on and tapped foul down the first baseline. And we'll do it again. Game playing out very similar to what the teams did yesterday, where they went through five scoreless innings and traded runs in the sixth, and then the Buckeyes put up two in the eighth, and the Bisons came back with two in the bottom of the ninth. So we've seen a couple of really good baseball games between these two teams here. Great early season action. You know it's going to help both teams as they approach their conference season to play these tightly contested games. Here comes the 1-2 to Pohl. And call strike three.
Tyler Guilfoyle. And he is a lot of fun to watch.
That's two strikeouts in a row after he walked Dingler to lead the inning, and that's going to bring up Archer Brookman, the first baseman. Brookman was a strikeout victim in the second, grounded out in the fourth, and walked in the sixth. So he is 0-for-2 on the day. And now 5-for-14 on the season for the junior Archer Brookman, batting with two outs, runner at second. And Lipscomb leading Ohio State 3-2. That misses down low, a 91-mile-an-hour fastball, one ball, no strikes. Dingler had quite a healthy lead that time off second base, particularly a secondary lead, so we'll see if the Bisons try to chase him back. Second baseman Adams is shading straight up the middle. He's about two steps to the left side, or to the first base side of second base. And breaking ball through there for strike one. One ball and one strike to Archer Brookman. Outfield straight away and deep. Preston way back on the third baseline behind the bag. Brian Moore on the grass at shortstop. And first baseman Chris Bashler also deep behind the bag guarding the line at first. So Bison's trying to take away those extra base hits here in the late innings. And it's a 1-1 pitch due to Brookman. And breaking ball in there for a strike. So one ball and two strikes. And as you mentioned, Spencer, seems like Guilfoyle's finding a bit of a rhythm and getting those breaking pitches located that we were struggling with when he first came out. We got a one ball, two strike count on Archer Brookman with two outs. And call strike three. Guilfoyle strikes out the side after allowing the opening walk. And that's going to keep the score right where it is in the middle of the eighth inning. Your score, Lipscomb 3 and Ohio State 2. You're watching Lipscomb Bisons Baseball on YouTube Live.
Bill Prady with SmartSource has had the privilege of serving the Lipscomb University community for 35 years. SmartSource provides the most innovative approach to printing promotional, apparel, and paper products, supported with technology-based services such as direct mail, fulfillment, and development of marketing resource centers. Please call Bill Prady at 615-516-0434. That's 615-516-0434 for a consultation.
New pitcher for Ohio State, number 38, Patrick Murphy.
We head to the bottom half of the eighth inning. Your score, Lipscomb 3, Ohio State 2. And new pitcher on the mound for the Buckeyes. He's the senior left-hander, Patrick Murphy, a 6'1", 215-pounder out of Canton, Ohio. Transfer from Marshall University. And he becomes the third Buckeye pitcher of the day. Smith started and went six innings, giving up one run, one earned run. Finning went one inning and responsible for the two runs that were given up. And now Murphy, the third Buckeye pitcher of the day, and he'll face 3, 4, and 5 for the Bisons, Maddox Houghton, Malik Williams, and Knox Preston. Again, your score is Lipscomb 3, Ohio State 2 in the bottom of the eighth inning. And Murphy on in relief for the Buckeyes.
Yeah, 7.71 ERA, 1-0 record in two appearances, has struck out 5 and walked 0, allowed 3 runs and 7 hits, and 2 of those runs earned. And
Houghton swings through a 93-mile-an-hour fastball. Maddox Houghton is 0-for-2 on the day with a sacrifice fly. He did drive in the Bison's first run back in the first inning. And the 0-1 tapped foul at the plate. That'll be no balls and two strikes on Maddox Houghton. So the Bison scored first. They picked up one run in the first inning, and then it was scoreless until the fifth. The Buckeyes put two on, and they led 2-1 going into the seventh. And the Bison's plated two last inning to take this 3-2 lead that they're clinging to here in the bottom half of the eighth inning. Houghton calls for and receives time. Here comes the 0-2 to Houghton. Checks his swing. Did he go? And they say he did. And that's going to be strike three on Maddox Houghton. So one down in the inning, and that'll bring up the designated hitter, Malik Williams. He struck out twice and singled, so 1-for-3 on the day for the Bison's designated hitter, the junior college transfer from Johnson Community College. He's 6'4", 241 pounds out of Toronto, Canada. And he takes an off-speed pitch outside for ball one. They're underway over next door at Draper Diamond, the Lipscomb Lady Bison softball team hosting Indiana State, and we have no score on that game. Again, the Lady Bisons have already won 2 of 3 in their Purple and Gold Classic this weekend. Williams swings through a breaking ball, and it's one ball and one strike. Third game of the three-game series. Ohio State winning on Friday, and Lipscomb coming back yesterday for a walk-off win. So three good ball games between these teams. Checks his swing, And that one's going to miss low. Two balls and one strike to Malik Williams. Knox Preston waits on deck. Here's the 2-1, and he swings through a slider. And that's going to be two balls and two strikes on Williams. Due up for the Buckeyes in the top of the ninth will be 7, 8, 9, Carafa, Bauer, and Irwin. As we look ahead to the ninth inning, I'm sure Coach Forehand would be happy to take a little insurance into that. Swung on and hit in toward the gap in left center field. That's going to get down for a base hit. Williams is going to make the turn at first, and he's going to hold there as Oakley comes over to cut it off. So Malik Williams has his second hit on the day. And the Bisons have a runner on now with one out for Knox Preston. Preston singled back in the first and was stranded. He grounded out in the fourth and flew out to center field in the sixth inning. So he's 1-for-3 on the day. Again, Preston was the hero of yesterday's game in that walk-off 5-4 win as he singled in the winning run in the bottom of the ninth for his first game-winning RBI for this freshman. Swings and fouls it out of play, and it'll be no balls and one strike on Knox Preston. Preston now with 6 hits and 22 trips on the season. Off to a good start for his college career. Here is a Lipscomb Bison. Again, Williams is your runner at first. There's one out in the bottom of the eighth inning, and Lipscomb leading Ohio State 3-2. That's going to bounce away from the catcher, Dingler, and that's going to allow Williams to get over to second base. So it's going to even the count at a ball and a strike. Just kicked off the glove of Dingler there, but got far enough away that Williams could trot down to second. So now he's in scoring position with one out. And a 1-1 count on Knox Preston.
Good to see Williams picking up two because he struck out in his first two at-bats for Lipscomb, so coming in clutch at the right time.
So he's in scoring position now with one out and a 1-1 count on Knox Preston. That one's going to bounce as well. That was a 93-mile-an-hour fastball and a really good play by Dingler there to keep it in front of him. Didn't bounce away as the last one did, but the count's going to be 2-1 on Knox Preston. Outfield straight away, normal depth. Again, the wind's blowing pretty hard towards the left field foul line, so it's kind of coming out of the south now. We've seen it swirl around in different areas. Early it was about 15 miles an hour. Pretty stiff breeze there on this Sunday afternoon. Here comes the 2-1 to Preston. Checks his swing and takes a breaking ball down low, looks like a slider, and it's going to be 3-1 now on Knox Preston. Don't see any activity down in the Ohio State bullpen, so this appears to be Murphy's game. Likewise, no activity in the Bison's bullpen, so Murphy and Guilfoyle going at it for their respective teams here. It's a 3-ball, 1-strike count on Knox Preston. Second baseman Bauer shading up the middle. How big hole on the right side of the infield. And Preston swings and fouls it at the plate. 3 balls and 2 strikes. That was where Preston put his game-winning hit yesterday. Hit a soft line drive out into right field. And got down in front of pole, and the Bisons were able to walk that one off with a 5-4 win. But the count's gone full on Knox Preston. And we'll see how Murphy elects to pitch him here. He's shown a fastball up around 90-91. He's been throwing that slider in the low 80s. A lot of bite on that, so another one of these outstanding arms that the Buckeyes have brought out this weekend. Here comes the payoff to Preston. And he swings through a fastball for strike 3. So Preston down on strikes, and that'll bring up Vaughn Watson. Watson came into the game back in the fifth inning. He's had one at bat. He flew out to left field back in the sixth, so he's 0-for-1 on the day. And he'll bat now with Williams on at second base. And 2 down for Lipscomb. 2 strikeouts in the inning now for Patrick Murphy, sandwiched around the single by Williams. And he swings through an off-speed pitch there for no balls and 1 strike. Ty Jones waits on deck if Watson were able to reach. Here comes the 0-1. And that one's going to bounce up there. Again, a 91-mile-an-hour fastball. So a lot of outstanding left-handed arms for Coach Greg Beals and this Ohio State team. We mentioned yesterday Seth Lonsway striking out 13 batters in 5 innings of work. He had come into yesterday's game with 24 strikeouts in 11 innings, so he's now struck out 37 on the season in 17 innings. So a lot of left-handed pitching talent for this Buckeyes team. Here's the 1-1. That one's going to bounce. It's going to get away from Dingler, and that's going to let Williams advance to third base. That looked like that slider, and it just bounced early, and Dingler really didn't have much chance. It kicked away from him. So Malik Williams is 90 feet away from home, and the count is 2-1 on Vaughn Watson. 2 outs. Bottom of the 8th inning, Lipscomb 3, Ohio State 2. Again, a reminder, if you're at the ballpark and listening in, it is Sunday Fun Day. Kids get to run the bases after the game, as well as autograph from the Bison's players. Here's the 2-1, and he swung through a slider there, and it's 2-2.
If they can bring Ty Jones on, if Williams is able to advance, Jones had a double for his second hit of the season earlier today. And you've got Malik Williams on third base for Lipscomb.
Here comes the 2-2 to Watson, and misses just low with that slider.
Wow, I was a little surprised at that call, but the ump can see it better than I can.
So we've got a full count now on Vaughn Watson. 3-2, 2 outs, Malik Williams running at third base, and here comes the payoff. And that's going to bounce as well.
There you go.
First walk of the inning for Murphy against 2 strikeouts. And so runners will be at the corners with 2 outs for Ty Jones. And as you mentioned, Jones doubled and scored a run in his last at-bat. He's also popped out to the catcher and grounded out to second base. 3 on the day for the sophomore Ty Jones, 5'11", 210 pounds out of Ringgold, Georgia in Ringgold High School. And he gets a chance to hit here. With 2 down and 2 on in the bottom of the 8th inning, Lipscomb leading Ohio State 3-2.
And this would be big, too. This would make Tyler Guilfoyle's work easier. I mean, you trust Tyler Guilfoyle with a 3-2 lead. If it's 4-2 or 5-2, Ohio State's in major danger going to the top of the 9th.
That one's going to be inside a 90-mile-an-hour fastball, ball one. I don't think there's a pitcher alive, Spencer, that wouldn't take a few more runs going to work with. So I think Guilfoyle would happily accept that trade-off. He did work an outstanding 8th inning, striking out 3 after issuing a leadoff walk. And here comes the 1-0 to Ty Jones. That one's going to bounce as well. So looks like that Murphy's lost a little control over that slider here. The last few that he's thrown have landed about 59 feet. And so Dingler's having to do a good job to block it up, because if it were to get through, you've got good speed on third base with Williams running. And that's the danger of that hard-biting slider, is if it kicks away to one side or the other, there's a fair bit of foul ground here at Ken Dugan Field. And so you run the risk of having that runner advance home from third. 2-0 to Ty Jones. That one's going to catch the inside corner, a 92-mile-an-hour fastball. And that'll make the count 2-0. So on the 2-0 pitch, it looks like Murphy went back to the fastball, not trusting that slider quite as much, that he's had a little trouble with control in the last couple of at-bats. He swings through a slider there, and it's 2-2. So Watson, your runner at first. Williams running at third. Ty Jones batting, and he's got a 2-2. Bottom of the 8th inning, Lipscomb 3, Ohio State 2. And they've got him picked off at first. Watson's going to try to stay in the rundown. That's going to allow Jones to come to the plate, and he's going to score the 4th run for the Bisons.
Wow, that was beautiful. My first thought was, oh, no, they're going to get Williams out, but what an incredible job. Watson. What an incredible job by Williams to just get home.
Yeah, Watson clearly was breaking early. It was a 2-2 pitch, and he broke early. He was picked off, and you could tell that he wanted to, once he realized he was going to be thrown out at second for the third out of the inning, he just stayed in the rundown, and for some reason.
Great awareness.
Williams with great awareness at third, and he scooted across the plate and was not able to be retired. So that's 4 runs on the day now for the Bisons, and we've still got a count of 2-2 on Ty Jones. Vaughn Watson now running at second with 2 outs in the bottom of the 8th. Swung on and hit towards the shortstop, DeCenzo. He feels it on the backhand, throws over to first, and Brookman is able to scoop it up. But the Bisons do pick up an insurance run, courtesy of that rundown play that we mentioned after the base hit by Malik Williams. And we head to the bottom or the top of the ninth inning. Your score, Lipscomb 4, Ohio State 2. You're watching Lipscomb Bisons Baseball on YouTube Live.
Lipscomb University Roberts Automotive Group for their support of Bison Athletics. Both Lipscomb graduates, John Roberts Sr. and John Roberts Jr., have been serving the Middle Tennessee community since 1983. Just a short drive to Manchester, Tennessee, or just a click away at johnrobertsautogroup.com will save you plenty on one of your family's most important purchases. Please visit either John Roberts Toyota or John Roberts Nissan for all your new, pre-owned, or automotive service needs.
We head to the top half of the ninth inning. Your score is Lipscomb 4 and Ohio State 2. And due up for the Buckeyes is 7, 8, 9. Nate Carafa, Colton Bauer, and Nick Irwin to face the Bison's closer, Tyler Guilfoyle, who worked an outstanding inning in the eighth. He issued a leadoff walk and then three straight strikeouts. And he gets ahead, nothing and one, to Carafa. Carafa has flown out to left field, struck out, and lined out to shortstop. So 0 for 3 on the day for Nate Carafa. That's an off-speed pitch that misses low. One ball and one strike.
You got the perfect situation, too. You're 7-8-9 for Ohio State and the closer, Tyler Guilfoyle, who has three saves this year, all three for Bison's pitchers.
Swung on and fouled out of play. It's a ball and two strikes on Carafa. So four runs, nine hits, and no errors for the Bisons. Two runs, six hits, and no errors for the Buckeyes. Fourth Bisons pitcher of the day, Tyler Guilfoyle. Bierman started, and he's relieved by Sills, Van Treek, Folsom, and Guilfoyle. Actually, the fifth pitcher of the day for the Bisons. Here comes the 1-2. Swung on and hit in the air towards left field. Jones coming on, and he gloves it.
There goes Ty Jones again, coming in clutch for Lipscomb. Had one of those diving catches very early on in the game and comes up again at a big moment. Just two more outs for the Bisons to go 2 of 3 against Ohio State.
Excellent defensive play there by Ty Jones. Sinking line drive, he never hesitated. Good first step, and he came in and gloved that one for out number one. And that'll bring up the second baseman, Colton Bauer. Bauer has a single in three trips today. He's also struck out and grounded out. Bases empty, one out, top of the ninth inning. Lipscomb 4, Ohio State 2. And that one's going to miss outside for ball one. Last check of the scoreboard of the A-Sun Conference. Kennesaw State has beaten Pennsylvania 6-5, and Stetson has beaten UMBC 5-0. Swung on and hit foul down the right side. That's going to get out of play, and the count's going to be a ball and a strike. Bethune-Cookman has beaten Florida Gulf Coast 9-1. North Florida beat Hartford 7-2. And that is your A-Sun scoreboard update for this afternoon.
Do you have a record on Florida Gulf Coast? Because that is the team that I believe is hosting the A-Sun tournament for baseball.
That's going to miss high. That's two balls and one strike. Yeah, Florida Gulf Coast losing today to Bethune-Cookman. I'll check their record for you here when we get a moment.
I can find it right here.
Here comes the 2-1. Swung on and fouled out of play. 2-2. That'll make Florida Gulf Coast 4-7 on the season.
And that's a little bit of a surprise, too.
So it's now a two-ball, two-strike count on Colton Bauer. One out, bases empty, top of the ninth inning, and Lipscomb holding a 4-2 lead over Ohio State. Tyler Guilfoyle on in his second inning of work for the Bisons after picking up the win in yesterday's game. Here comes the 2-2. Swung on, tapped foul. Updated score from next door at softball. Indiana State is now leading Lipscomb 1-0 in the bottom of the second inning. So softball action still ongoing over at Draper Diamond in this Purple and Gold Classic that's been going on all weekend. The Lady Bison softball team already with a couple of victories on the weekend. Here's the 2-2. Swung on and fouled out of play again. So Tip your hat to Bauer. He's been hanging tough here and extending the at-bat against Guilfoyle. Do have an update on a New Jersey Tech score. I'm almost wondering if this one could be true, but it says New Jersey Tech 23 and Bucknell 14. So I don't know if that was baseball or if they're doing a spring football scrimmage. But
I don't know.
That's our listed score there on that one. Here anyway, we got a 2-2 pitch due. Swung on and fouled back again by Colton Bauer.
NJIT jumped up from D2 several years ago. They've been able to make some noise in athletics.
So the count remains 2-2 on Colton Bauer. Nick Irwin waits on deck. There's one out, and the bases are empty here in the top of the ninth inning. Comes the 2-2. And swing and a miss.
And here you go. Your next guy is going to be Irwin, who hit the only score for the Buckeyes today, that two-run homer in the top of the fifth inning.
Fourth strikeout on the day for Tyler Guilfoyle. And as you mentioned, Irwin has had a home run today and three trips to the plate. He also flew out to left field, and he's walked. So 1-for-2 officially, and the Buckeyes down to their final out here. That one's going to miss high. Four ball one on Nick Irwin. Leadoff man Oakley would be next, but two outs here in the top of the ninth inning for the Buckeyes. And that's a fastball through there for strike one. One ball and one strike on Irwin.
And again, this is big. This game would improve Lipscomb to 8-2 if they can hold on and give them a 2-out-of-3 advantage over Ohio State.
And strike two called on the off-speed pitch. And the Buckeyes are down to their final strike here. We got a one ball, two strike count on Nick Irwin. Sophomore closer Tyler Guilfoyle trying to shut the door right here. Here comes the 1-2. Swung on and hit in the air towards right center field. Watson ranging over. He's under it. And he gloves it. This one's in the books. And you can wrap it in purple and gold.
8-2, 2-out-of-3 against Ohio State. A statement series for Lipscomb. They started out the season 6-0, slid in a couple of games, but rebounded very well with the walk-off win yesterday and then the 4-2 win today. What an incredible start to the year for Coach Forehand and his baseball squad.
So the final line score on today's game, for the Bisons, 4 runs on 9 hits and no errors. For the Buckeyes, 2 runs and 6 hits and no errors. I believe the winning pitcher on the day is going to be Wyatt Folsom. I believe we have that correct. And the loser will be Will Finnig. And Tyler Guilfoyle will pick up his 4th save on the season. The time of the game is 2 hours and 32 minutes. Let's recap this one. Again, the Bisons got off to a fast start, scoring a run in the first inning. Haddon Adams singled, Chris Bashler singled, and then Maddox Houghton had a sacrifice fly. And we stayed 1-0 until we got into the 5th inning. In the 5th, Colton Bauer singled, and then Nick Irwin hit a 2-run home run for the Buckeyes scoring on the day. That made the score 2-1, and we remained there until we got to the 7th inning, when Ty Jones led off with a double. Chaz Bertolani singled on a bunt. Brian Moore put a bunt down, then an error was committed on. That allowed Jones to score. And then Haddon Adams hit a sacrifice fly to bring Bertolani in. So that was 4 runs on the day for the Bisons. And they were able to use that for the margin of victory because Tyler Guilfoyle came in, walked the first man he faced in the 8th inning, and then struck out 3 in a row. And here in the 9th inning, he goes 3 up, 3 down, including 1 strikeout. So 4 strikeouts for the outstanding sophomore closer, Tyler Guilfoyle. And a big series win for the Bisons as they take 2 out of 3 from Ohio State on the weekend, winning 5-4 on Saturday and a 4-2 victory here today. A reminder that the next action for the Lipscomb Bisons baseball team will be on Tuesday, March the 3rd, when the Bisons will be at Middle Tennessee State University over in Murfreesboro. First pitch there is 3 p.m. Our next broadcast here will be on Tuesday, the 10th of March. The Bisons host Austin Peay here at Dugan Field. First pitch is 4:05, and we'll be on the air at 4 p.m. Central Time. Our special thanks to Lipscomb Athletic Director Philip Hutchison, Associate Athletic Director Brent McMillan, Director of Sports Communication Kirk Downs, and Baseball Communications Director Jack Bloom. On behalf of our crew today, Technical Director Will Wright, our engineer Tanner Hibbs, and my color commentator Spencer Bohm. This is Doc Allen saying thanks for your time this time, and till next time, so long. You've been watching Lipscomb Bisons Baseball on YouTube Live.